Hi, everyone. You're here at the Take Back the Vote conference in Richmond, California. This is Sunday. We're going to be live streaming all day. We'll probably do three parts live stream so that we can save the videos for you later. You can come back and watch us. We have amazing speakers, starting off with Bob Fitrakis. We'll have Bev Harris calling in from Hawaii, so we can listen to her and her what project she's been working on, a movie, a short documentary called Fraction Magic. And we have John Brady, who came out of Arizona, and many more. We're so excited to be with you from home. Those of you who are here, we'll be asking a lot of questions. You can ask questions while you're from home on your computer. We'll be watching the chat, and we'll try to get them in through the Q&A period. So get started. All right. Thank you so much. Stay tuned. We're about to get started.
Where does this go? I don't even know where it goes. Want a little more tape on it?
We're starting. I'm Bob Fitrakis. I write for the freepress.org, and I'm worked with as a fellow for trustvote.org. And a lot of exciting information will be coming out today, beginning with Jim Soper. But also we've got Jonathan Simon, who's here, who's also written a very important book, Code Red, regarding how there's an attempt, as these machines increasingly fail to give us the correct number, there's been an assault on polling. What they would have us believe is that the universal laws of statistics apply everywhere on Earth, but in the United States. So the fact that our own State Department uses statistics to determine the legitimacy of elections overseas is completely ignored. So I'll make sure when I speak a little later today that Jonathan Simon can come up and have some of my time. I think you'll really appreciate his perspective as well. I know we're starting late here, so I'm not going to say much other than, you know, the battle's on. I said it yesterday. I think future historians will record what went on here today, and I also think coming out of here will be a sort of united front of election activists in California that are absolutely prepared for whatever comes, be it this fall or in the future. So, with that in mind, Jim Soper of the Voting Rights Task Force will be discussing recent changes in California election law and hints on how to lobby the legislative branch in Sacramento. I give you Jim Soper.
My name's Jim, and this is hard to say, but I'm an election addict. And I've been. I've been an election addict, and I have proof, since February 26, 2005. That's when this button is from that conference, the very first National Teacher Election Meeting 101 put on by the Voting Rights Task Force. Now, This talk is actually going to be two talks. It originally started out split, but we wanted to find some time and try and scrunch it together, so I'm going to have to go quick here. We'll start out by talking about what's coming in California elections. There have been major changes due to laws being passed this summer. And so everything's going to be changing after this coming election, and you should be aware of it, and you should be preparing to do some things about it. Then we're also going to be talking about how to lobby in Sacramento, how to make things happen. This is something the Voting Rights Task Force has been focusing on for the past few years, and we've been fairly successful. And some of this, much of this applies to Sacramento, but I'm sure it applies to legislatures all over the country and to a certain degree to even Congress. Now, myself, I am the author of a website called countedasgas.org and countedasgas.com, which is an older version but still up there. I'm co-chair of the Voting Rights Task Force, which was founded back in November 2004. I was a member of the San Francisco Voting Systems Task Force that reported to the Board of Supervisors of the City and County of San Francisco about what they should do moving forward. I am a geek, senior software consultant and mobile app developer. My email is jimsoper2@gmail.com, and please feel free to email me. Again, we're going to talk first about some new election systems coming down the pike. SB 450, a couple other bills, lobbying in Sacramento, and time permitting some ideas for some things that we're going to try to do in the next few years. New election systems. There's some major changes coming down. The Election Assistance Commission does federal testing for new systems, and it's time-consuming. It can take half a year to a year, cost $1 million, so we're not seeing much happen there. California, there's the slide coming up, California had dumped federal testing. We do our own. And we do it better than the federals do. Now, they're writing new standards, but our standards include hack testing and better standards for people with disabilities. There are at least six systems coming down the line that are to varying degrees open source. This means programmers or anybody in theory can look at the source code. Los Angeles has been at it since 2009. They're supposed to come out in 2 years with their first systems. They're not going to do it all over, but phase it in. We'll look at that in a moment. San Francisco, we have been working in San Francisco for 10 years to get San Francisco to adopt open source. And finally, the city adopted a budget of $300,000. They're going to hire a program or project manager this year. They're in the process of setting up the paperwork they have to do for that. But he's supposed to lay out a plan about how they're going to build a new system. That one will be open source. Los Angeles is not clear. I've talked with the registrar there, and he's not at this point willing to commit to open source. But from certain indications, you will at least be able to see it. The difference is with this closed source, you cannot sell it. You cannot use it, you cannot sell it. But you can at least read the code and find out what's going on inside if you know how to read computer code. That's the most important part. There's a project called StarVote in Travis County, Texas, which has had some world-class experts working on it in election systems and especially security. A company called Galois that has good leadership, osetfoundation.org, have some projects that they're trying to find partners for. And Prime Voting System, Prime 3, from Juan Gilbert at the University of Florida, has something running that's been used for helping the disabled to vote in New Hampshire. I don't think it's federally certified yet. But all of this is coming down. It's coming. It's coming. And so we won't have to deal with the secret machines anymore. there are going to be changes. Most of the systems use some kind of configuration of a ballot printing device. Generally, and we'll look at LA, you sit there and you vote on a touchscreen and you say, print the ballot. And it doesn't list all of the candidates with a little X or circles to mark. As in this example, it just lists the office and who you voted for. That's different. So most of these systems are going to do that. It saves paper, it's quicker, and so on. But you get a ballot. And you can check that paper. You get a paper ballot. You can check that paper before it goes into the ballot box. So it's verifiable. LA is doing a new system. It has, this is the outline. They have the touchscreen machine there. On the right is a thing where you can feed in your ballot. If you happen to have a printed ballot, you can feed it in. It will read it to you. And then you go into the touchscreen. Check what it says, and then you say okay, and you can still see the paper before it goes into the box. On the left is some devices for those with disabilities. You have headphones and arrow keys, big arrow keys, and so on to help those with disabilities to vote. You can also, this is one innovation with the LA system, you can go home and set up they call it a sample ballot at home on your phone. And you go home, download the ballot for your precinct, and you go vote. And you say save. And then you bring it in. And you can put it underneath a certain reader that will read that box code. And we'll put that up on the screen. What's on your phone is not the official ballot. But it just lets you at home do whatever you want to prepare ahead of time, go in, show it to the ballot machine. It puts the ballot up on the screen, you approve it, and you move forward. There is a problem with this. What they're proposing so far in LA is that when you print out the ballot, and I had to take this off of the video so it's not all that clear, there's a square code that's called a QR code that will come out on the ballot. The scanner's going to read that QR code. It's not going to read the names on the ballot. We need some kind of good audit. The registrar has said you will be able, in Los Angeles County at least, this is his intention, you will be able to bring your phone in, show that QR code to your phone, and if it's been downloaded with proper app, it will tell you what that QR code is saying. So that will be one way to check it. We want to work out another way. I want to have a program similar to what's done with Humboldt County to read the names on the ballot, but it's a big challenge. They have $3 million to read. And in order to read $3 million, the program's got to be quick, so we're going to work on that. Minnie Kennedy put up a 10-minute video at this YouTube to show you how that system works. It's good, but we won't take the time to look at it now. If you go, I saw you trying to write. Can you just go back one? Somebody was wanting to get the YouTube address down there. Next, we're going to get the... Are we okay?
Yeah, no, they need to write that. Can you say it okay?
YouTube.com watch question mark V equal good God 9QAF B capital B capital D capital X J capital G capital lowercase X capital U. If you look for on YouTube, look for Minnie Kennedy LA voting system, I'm sure you'll find it. New California laws, I'm afraid to ask. There's been a lot happening. First of all, a little bit of background here. There is a very important website, legendfor.legislature.ca.gov. Right now, until November, you can type in legendfor.ca.gov, you'll get to this page. But it has all the bills, and it has a link up here to California law. When you get to this page, you can go in the upper right-hand corner here and type in a bill number, for example, SB 450. And it will give you the information about SB 450, including from the text, a history of the votes in committees and so on, so you can find out who voted aye and nay. Some more history, the analysis by the consultants that we'll talk about later, the law as it stands amended, and some other things, the status here. So if something's enrolled, for example, a number of bills were enrolled, that means it passed the legislature and is on the governor's desk. But this is a place where you will find a lot of information. If you click on the second tab, you get to the California Elections Code. We have 21 divisions, 21 chapters. This is big, but you need to read not all of it, but if you're focusing on recall elections or the information about the law about ballots, election day procedures, is Division 14. This is where you go. This is the rule book. This is the major rule book. There's several of them, but this is the big one. As I said, California does its own testing. And then we get to the big bill for the summer, SB 450, by Senator Ben Allen, who is the chair of the Elections Committee in the Senate. You'll find, again, the information at the website I pointed out, or if you go look at my website, countedascast.org, on the right, you'll see some things about 450, and you'll get my take on this bill. This is a county opt-in. One of the things the legislature did not like to do is spend money. And if they tell the counties you have to do this, this, and this, then the state has to pay for it. It's called a mandate. They set this up to be an opt-in. If the county chooses to do it, then the county pays for it. Now, they think that the counties are likely to save money with this, so they're going to opt in. But still, it's an opt in. In 2018, there's some 14 counties that will have the opportunity to opt in. By 2020, any county in the state, including LA, which has its own rules, its own section. The major thing here is that vote-by-mail ballots will be sent to everybody, whether you ask for it or not. Sent to everybody. They can do that, according to the bill, if they also have some other conditions. One, they have to have drop-off locations, boxes or something, starting 20 days ahead of the election. That's the first condition. The second one is even more interesting. They have to set up bus centers. And I have the parts of the law that this affects where you can go dig up this information. Vote centers will be open 10 days before the election through 4 days before the election. One center for every 50,000 voters, registered voters. Roughly, there's one precinct for every 1,000 voters. So we're going to cut to 1/50th the numbers. 4 days, 10 days before through. You can't go do a 450 unless you have this set up. Now, this means that the voter registration database has to be connected to some kind of network live. California just connected to the counties to the statewide database. this year. And if we had some problems with our voter registration databases, and indeed we did, it's because it's new. But in 2 years, with the 14 counties, they're going to try to get this settled in. But with that live information, they're going to let you register there. And if you walk in and say, hey, I've been voting Republican for 40 years, what do you mean on peace and freedom? You'll be able to change it. If you were registered American Independent and wanted to vote Bernie, you'll be able to change it there, right there. Hopefully, that's the intention. There is a big issue that needs to be sorted out. Maybe Kennedy may bring this up again. If you send in a vote by mail, if they receive a vote by mail ballot, and then you walk in and say, I want to vote, and you walk in person with some kind of ID signature, that in-person vote should override any vote by mail ballot. Now, a lot of counties try to set up their vote by mail processing, those that are already arrived, so that they go quickly. We're going to have to try to get the counties to say, no, if you have an in-person vote, that overrides the vote by mail. Because it's more secure. You know who voted. There's a lot of issues with vote by mail that we'll get into. So that's something we're going to have to focus on in the future. Another big thing, and especially Ballots for Bernie has been focusing on getting county groups for observing and getting organized by counties. These SB 450 requires the counties to publish election plans, how they're going to do things, and a whole bunch of detail. And they have to have public hearings about this. So you need to keep tabs in your county about when this plan is going to come out, and when they're going to have hearings. And you want to try to be proactive and say, we need to look at this, this, and this. There's a whole bunch of issues there, but I've left some code numbers so you can see, look it up. They'll also have plans for people who speak English as a second language and who have people with disabilities. County groups, this is where the county groups become, are really important. The plans are made by county, and you have hearings, to. With SB 450, if a county opts in, your precinct polling place will disappear. Poof, gone. Some of them still keep the concept of precincts, but anybody can go into any vote center in the county, anyone, and vote there. Well, LA County has 4,500 precincts. They're not going to sit there and sort of ballots in a popular vote center by 4,500 precincts overnight and try to do what is standardly called a hand count of paper ballots in the precinct. That becomes logistically impossible. If you are really in favor of hand count of paper ballots in the precinct, you're going to have to lobby your county to not opt in. It's a county decision. So that's your supervisors. It's not Sacramento, it's your local supervisors. And now, I don't know how they're going to do the 1% manual tally with this. I hope they're going to do something reasonable. Risk-limiting audits provides one way of doing this. Quick question here.
Specifically, do not opt into what?
SB 450. It's a whole... either opt into the whole thing or not at all. Lori, good question.
If all things are mail in, will we know when to expect a ballot by? Because I've had something lost in the mail where I didn't get a ballot.
That's a different issue. We'll get to that.
And also, the other thing is, will it be a time where we can talk about Fadilla doing the testing, and Fadilla also is on the committee with Homeland Security?
Well, I might get to some of that. We have some other speakers that may touch on that. The question is, will we get to Secretary Padilla? Now, sort of answers your vote by mail notice. In this 450, it says that an official shall make a reasonable effort to inform a voter if their ballot is missing a signature. What you define as a reasonable effort, I don't know. I think, you know, if they can, if they can't have your phone number, if they have your email, then they need to call, contact you within a couple days. There was a bill that went beyond that and said you're supposed to get notified if your vote by mail ballot was not counted for numerous reasons. The signature didn't match, the address was missing. The first part is just that the signature's missing, but there's a 10 other reasons the vote by mail ballot can wind up not being counted. There was a bill to say, well, at least you got to be notified within 30 days if it's not counted. The governor vetoed that. It's not good. So if this is not enough, we'll get into vote by mail again in a little while. The issue of primaries and crossover ballots, what the rules are for crossover ballots, which we saw in June and caused so much havoc, aside from the fact that people were showing up where the voter registration changed. All of that is the one section in the California Elections Code about the rules for who can vote in crossover ballots and how you set up the primaries for the individual parties. That's Division 6. Generally, there was a law, and generally the counties were following that. Somebody called me in June and said, well, are the counties required, are they required by the law to tell you that you have a right for a crossover ballot? I went and dug through, and the only thing I saw was back when you were registering, there was a little notice somehow that you have a right for a crossover ballot. There was, to my knowledge, nothing in the law that required the county to tell the voter that they had the right to a crossover ballot. That should have been up to the campaigns to notify the voters. This is something, yeah, we want to see fixed. And the good news is I have been assured by the legislative director for Secretary Padilla and by the chief consultant for Senator Ben Allen and the Elections Committee that they got the message and they're going to rewrite this law. The section of code. Exactly what they're going to do, I don't know. But they got a message that it was a mess, and hopefully they'll clean some of that up. To a certain degree, this is determined by the parties themselves, but they may say, the heck with it, we're running the election, we're going to simplify it so it's not this mess. We had another important bill, AB 1970, by Assemblymember Lowe down in San Mateo County. It said that the Secretary of State shall write new regulations for the processing of vote-by-mail ballots and new regulations for the processing of provisional ballots. And the governor signed this. It's in the law, so sometime in the next year or two, we can expect the Secretary of State to start writing regulations for the processing of vote-by-mail and provisional ballots. What this means for you is you want to pay attention, especially those who are getting deep experience in how these things are processed. You want to get together, you want to work up a list of what needs to be done, what needs to be improved. And when they want to contact the Secretary of State's office early, the legislator's name is James Schwab. I believe his email is james.schwab@ca.sos.ca.gov. And start giving them your input. Try to do this as a group. Things should be well considered. But this is a place you can give your input. Now, the law
trumps regulations. So there may be places we have to change the law. But where the law is sort of silent about some issues, the secretary can write regulations, which has to go through a public hearing process. So that's going to come up. That's going to be really important for all the things we've learned this year. Now, the bad news is that Secretary Padilla just issued a memo in mid-September saying it's his interpretation that the election code does not require that the 1% manual tally cover provision of open mail ballots. With the good work of Ralettes, that may change. The judge says something different. The judge, at least in San Diego County, trumps the secretary. I hate to use the word Trump, but he trumps the secretary. And then if it goes and wins in an appeal court and so on, then it starts to apply to all of California. And that's why that trial is really important. Thank you, Ralettes. We had quickly one bill, AB 1921, which allowed for unlimited ballot harvesting. Before, the law said you can deliver a vote by mail ballot for somebody if you were a family or a household member. They crossed that out to anybody, which means you could bring in a truckload of vote by mail ballots. And there's no questions asked. No records kept of who's bringing in those ballots. You can have vote selling, vote buying, etc. All right, we fought this. We didn't win. Governor Brown signed it. Our best allies, in this case, were the Republicans. Okay, now we're going to switch to the other one here. I will post this online late tonight on countingascast.org, along with some of the other slides.
Jim, is there a movement afoot to, for a bill to counteract the 1921?
Is there a movement afoot to counteract that? We're doing a list of things we need to do to counteract that. In this case, we said, okay, anybody can deliver ballots, but we want to know who did it. With positive ID. So if somebody brings in a truckload of ballots, then, all right, we want to know who brought them in. So that if you start to notice something fishy, you know who brought them in. Right now, no questions asked. No questions asked. Let's see, how do we... No, that's not it. Sorry.
By the way, if you have your question, please come and get the mic because we're live streaming and your question won't be heard.
I know I've used this before. You... Where? Second part is lobbying Sacramento. Do we have any questions about what it was talking about? Now, the Voting Rights Task Force, by the way, a little quick history of Voting Rights Task Force. We were founded in November 2004. We had the first election rigging teach-in on February 26, 2005. That's where I got hooked. I will not forget talking to Jim March on the steps of the church in Oakland and him telling me that the Nebo voting systems were programmed by somebody named Jeffrey Dean with 23 convictions for embezzlement. A and he's programming with me. So I'm a programmer, and I said, no, I don't need to hear about exit polls. I know enough right there. So we had to push to get really good auditing, in-counted auditing, and to get open source, or at least disclosed source. Very quickly about the success. In 2005-2006, we lobbied Alameda County very heavily. This was our first major action after the teach-in. We threw Diebold out of Alameda County. We kept track of what the registrar was saying, and some of that was not entirely accurate. She wound up leaving. To Marin, yeah. Sorry, Marin. And Alameda County started to return to paper ballots. Long story short, again, Republicans, conservatives can be your best friend. We did so much lobbying that Mr. Haggerty threw an amendment to give us something. They went and bought Sequoia Systems. But he wanted to give us something. He says, okay. In November 2006, the registrar will count all of the ballots on the touch screens as recorded by these long paper trail rolls of voting, verified voter paper audit trail. They're going to count those by hand. That was the one roll, one election, 2006. The registrar said, no, I don't want to do that. So he took the touch screen machines and shoved them in the corner and gave everybody paper ballots. That was the election that Deborah Boyd got elected, and by golly, the next August, she's putting in the same rule. So almost all of California votes on paper ballots because of what we started in Alameda County. We can't have enough. And this was, there was a lot of luck. We didn't know Mr. Haggerty was going to do this, Supervisor Haggerty. It just came in out of the blue. Boom. We didn't see the implications until later, but we can trace it back to that. 2006, we got Deborah Bowen elected. Huge statewide campaign. She had a top-to-bottom review. One of the very first reports saying these systems are hackable. I have on a link down there, you'll see it on the counter in this cast, a page. Thank you, Deborah Bowen. She did a lot of things that people don't know about, that you only know about if you're up there a lot and talking to people and working with her. The voter quest task force succeeded in helping change the law. I had an interview in 2001, and at the end I said, you know, some point, we're already influencing the law, at some point we're going to start changing, we're going to write it. Well, in 2013, our Riverside colleague Tom Corbett got his Republican Assemblywoman Melendez to introduce a bill, AB 813, that required that the counties post what's called the detailed precinct reports. How many votes each candidate got in each precinct 30 days after the election. We wanted election night, but they didn't want to go that hard. They wanted to make sure they got a bill passed. So they said 30 days after the election, it was passed and signed by the governor, and the Voting Rights Task Force was there to help Tom get this thing done. Thank you, Tom. This year, AB 2824 was the same idea, only detailed precinct reports on the internet, not 30 days later, but starting on election night, and then at some regular periods thereafter. We got it introduced, but we ran out of time. The registrars were giving us some resistance. The Appropriations Committee said, we think you could negotiate something, but you're out of time. We're going to go back. And we also, for example, supported AB 44 from last year, which for the first time introduced, however feeble, automatic statewide recounts. That got passed again on luck the year before. Somebody was running for state controller, and he narrowly
missed second place. He wound up third. So he couldn't go on to the November election. And it turned out that that person who lost was the Speaker of the Assembly. His name escapes me for the moment. He was the Speaker of the Assembly. Dumb luck. He also got the idea we have to have recounts. He was powerful. And then we got 8044 passed. The VRTF blocked four internet voting bills. Mostly credit goes to the Secretaries of State. We don't have their clout. But for three of the bills, the voting rights task was the only people from the public to show up at the hearings. Four of us. But we stood up, we said, no, you don't want to do this. We went and talked to staffers and so on. And we blocked four of them. They're going to come back. They're going to try again. But we blocked four. And a note about Secretary Padilla, a couple years ago, he was saying, well, we need to look into internet voting. Then people started to talk to him. And during the election, he came out and said elections must be auditable. And last January, there was a bill, the last one that was up in front of the Elections Committee in the Assembly, or the Senate, and it died because Padilla essentially said no. Thank you there, Alex Padilla. That was our minimum that we wanted to see a candidate, and that's, he produced it at that point. Internet voting, David Jefferson's going to speak later this morning, is the overriding issue in Trump's again. Everything else. Again, we're just three or four people doing this. We're looking forward to making that 300. You can have an impact. You've got to be organized and dedicated. On the left is Carl Carter, me, Deborah Bowen, and Richard Chan sitting back there.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is May here yet? Not yet. We also blocked, I can't say we blocked, but there were three internet voting initiatives that were collecting signatures or were allowed to collect signatures. Two of them were backed by a billionaire. This came out last January, and we went, oh no. Because now they're taking it to the public, and a billionaire can put up an ad saying, oh, it'd be great to vote on your cell phone, et cetera, et cetera. We did not wait to see if it made it on the ballot. We went, boom, this is the overriding issue, and Richard and I went down to the Democratic Convention and passed out 1,200 flyers in one day. And I'll tell you, there were a lot of leadership in the party that did not know that this was coming. So I don't know if we've made any real difference, but we weren't going to sit down and do nothing. A little bit about the legislature. You don't want to see sausages being made, but, you know, that's what happens. The Senate has 40 minutes, members. The Elections Committee has five. Their chief consultant is Darren Chesson. Assembly, 80 members. Any bill to pass a vote has to get 50% plus one vote. So if you have five members, you have to have three votes. And abstention is the same as the no vote. They have to collect ayes. We've been in situations where there was one of these internet voting bills and the fifth senator wasn't in. And it was Mimi's, or assembly member, Mimi's assembly member. We were going down and, you know, telling people to call his office and say, no. And he wound up abstaining. And that killed the bill. Steps for passing a bill. This is basic stuff. The bill will get introduced in the Assembly or the Senate. It doesn't matter which. There's no rules about, like, the House has to initiate spending initiatives. And that's got to happen before March.
then it will go to the elections committee. If it's going to spend money, it goes through appropriations. Then it goes to the full assembly, over to the Senate Elections Committee of the opposite house. If it's spending money, to the Appropriations Committee, the full Senate. I'm not sure about this. There's some kind of revote to make sure both houses confirm the exact same language, and then it gets signed or vetoed by the governor often in September. A legislative session runs for 2 years. Starting an odd number of years, so we're starting a new two-year cycle in January. If a bill is not outright killed in 1 year, it can go on to the next year in the same session. If it does not make it through that second year, you have to restart the whole thing again. Again, this is an important site to go look at all of this information. You go and you write proposals, and you go in and you write up, think of proposals, and take them in and try to find somebody to submit it as a bill. You want to do something that's achievable and then get useful results. You know, I can think of lots of things to do, proportional representation. Maybe someday we'll get that, but I'm not going to try that right now. Bills that cost a lot of money, or real money, are much harder to pass. There was a time in the budget crisis that they cost a dime, they didn't want to hear about it. Be focused. You can't do it all. You can take one or two office ideas to an office somebody you're visiting. Don't go in with a dozen. You're going to confuse them. You're the expert. You decide what's important. You can go to different offices with different proposals, but don't go in with a dozen. VRTF, the first time we did this, everybody had their own ideas, so we went in with a dozen and got nowhere. Any legislator can introduce a bill. It helps if they're on the elections committee, so go find out who's on the elections committee. It helps to be a constituent, especially if you're campaigning. Thank you, Richard Tan, who campaigned heavily for Assemblymember Thurman. And we walked into Thurman's office. He was in the lobby, and we went and talked to the staff, and he just says, give him whatever he wants. Because Richard went out and spent a lot of time campaigning. Republicans could be your best ally. In general, you try to reach the decision makers, at least to be able to talk to them or staffers. The legislators have a quota of about 20 bills that they can introduce each year. The staffers, it's really rare to sit down with the legislator. That's happened just a couple of times. But you talk with the staffer, they'll write a report to their boss about what was said. They're not going to give you their opinion generally. They'll just give you their boss's opinion. That's the way things work. Unless that legislator is on an elections committee, they may not know much, so be prepared to go in and explain things. A few tips: be professional, dress well, bring a printed copy, read about how to sell and market ideas. This will not go down well in this audience, but don't talk about stolen elections unless you know who you're talking to. Because if you go in and say, these elections were stolen, you're going to get them to tune out. The issue is transparency. That's what we want. We want to prove that the results are correct. We want to prove it. So focus on that. And unless there's some people who will be sympathetic to the idea that this, that, or the other election is stolen, but don't bring it up. They'll see you again if you're a constituent, if you go to Democratic or Republican clubs, get money, or if you're experts. In the case of the Voting Rights Task Force, we did our homework. We saw Congresswoman Zoe Lofgren's 4 times, even though we are not constituents. But the first time we spent several days preparing a slideshow presentation like this to talk to her about things going on in Washington. We came in well prepared. We got invited back. When there are some deadlines, you want to get your proposal in mid-January. find somebody who's at least willing to submit it. It's got to go through something like Ledge Council. Your legislator may do this as a courtesy. The bill has to be introduced by late February. Ledge Council is lawyers who work with the legislature. They read the proposal and they reword it into good legalese. They may not know much about election law. A bad one could really mangle what you wanted to do. The proposal should talk about the problem, how this bill addresses the problem, the cost, and the benefits. There is an example, again, how this slides up late tonight on countydiscast.org that I wrote up in 2009, just an example. You can either try to write the legal language yourself, which is not that hard, but we had one which was complicated, and there you can just say, it is our intent that this should just happen. And the Ledge Council will turn that into legalese. It's going up on Tony Discast late tonight. On the front page, you'll see this information. Just quickly, the person who introduces the bill owns the bill. It's not your bill. It's his or hers. Committee hearings, there's just some notes here. I'm running out of time. We've got to go to Q&A. There's information just about how committee hearings work. They are theater. Get used to it. The consultants are really important. The committee, election committee consultants, they know what they're doing. You want to talk to them, you know, like in December. You have some ideas, you want to sit down and talk with them. Obviously, I'm the Senate Elections Committee and say, well, what about this, and that? Give me some good feedback. More on committee hearings. Appropriations, if the bill costs money, it's got to go through appropriations. And they have to consider sometimes as many as 500 in a day, which is shocking. This is sausage. And you don't get to talk then. You just hope it gets through. There are floor votes then, and the governor signs. California Association of Clerks and Elections Officials is the registrar's organization. You want to at least get them, their legislative committee, to say we have no position on this bill. If you can't get them to say we like it, at least no position. If they have, they oppose, then you have a problem. They are not the enemy. They're trying to keep their, I'm going to repeat that, they are not the enemy. They just want to keep their jobs as simple as possible. It's not evil, it's what most people want to do. We're looking for transparency. That's what we're looking for. County supervisors, some hints there. I'm running again out of time. One really interesting note is when you go in and talk, you often can talk to the supervisor on an important date coming up. You're dealing with a boss, and so how that works, you're dealing with their personality. And Haggerty, who put in that amendment to require paper ballots, we walked in. And only two of us wanted to dare walk in and talk to a conservative. We walked in and boom. He barely says hello and says, you're not going to tell me the government can do a better job than private industry. And he's peppering me with questions right off the bat. No presentation, boom, boom, boom. I figured out later what he was doing was trying to get answers to give to his own constituents. And I like him, he was interesting. A little bit more about the supervisor meetings. There are two federal bills that Mimi's going to talk about that are hugely important. We have to get the whole country behind these, including, especially starting with the congressman. Here's a list, short list of possible future bills we want. We'll go back with detailed precinct reports, improve auditing. What do we do to really allow people to observe elections? We don't want 58 county chaos. We need to move toward standards. The vote by mail has a lot of leaks in it, especially in the part about notifying the voter if there was a problem. If you vote, it's not going to, ballot's not going to get counted. We need to fix that up. I will skip this. You can make a difference. The VRTF accomplished all of this at times with just three or four people.
here's some tips on how to do it. We have a new team, the California Elections, Election Integrity, and this bill that I got, Election Integrity Coalition. This is Ballots for Bernie. We are delighted to be working with them because we need a lot of work. Questions? We have just a couple.
If you have a question, Jim, you acknowledge who they are and I'll hand them the mic.
John?
Thank you, Jim. I'm very interested in the technology that LA is doing, and I don't know if you can answer this question or not, but is it using the old type technology, the mark sensor technology, where it reflects light off the ballot and picks up the mark, or is it a ballot image?
Current technology in LA is an ink of volume. It's like a computer card. You mark a dot on the card with ink, and that's what gets read. That's currently what they're going to do afterwards with that new system is print out the ballot with the names on it and that code, and they're going to read that code.
But
I don't know if they keep. I've seen no plans for them to keep the images of the ballot. Yes, we want to try to push that.
I just want to know, you know, because when you described the punch card, that was a reflective type system, a mark. It sends a mark.
Yeah.
And the newer technology that's being developed, like Third Ballot, ESNS, Dominion.
They're doing their own system in LA.
What? I know, but I just want to know what it is, because off the shelf is these.
You have to go to LA, go to Dominion. Yeah,
that's all.
Okay.
Thank you.
Here.
I wanted to go back to discussing Padilla, and you know, he's going to be in charge of the testing. You know, although he has part of the group and he's part of Homeland Security, and I'm concerned. Also, I got an extra concern when he's opposing the thing of Ray Lutz, and I start worrying that we have another form of Big Brother in the form of Padilla.
Padilla at least opposed the internet voting. But getting the Vice Secretary of State elected is huge. That was the biggest accomplishment of that and the Alameda County stuff, that first decade. I will just say we have two other technologists here who are more qualified to speak, but I have an opinion here. If you read the book called Countdown to Zero Day, you start to understand that anybody on the internet can get to anything on the internet or not. The government shut down, or shall we say ruined, centrifuges that they run on buried deep under a hole. They ruined centrifuges that were not connected to the internet. But the programmers were, and they rewrote programs to control the centrifuge, and so their little device got infected. They took it over to the centrifuge, and it was a super brilliant operation. In the same book, Countdown to Zero Day, she says, Kim Setter says, there were 8 or 9 power stations in this country. If you shut down just 8 or 9 power stations over the internet, you shut down electricity for the entire country. If you shut down the computers for Wall Street, you've got a huge problem. If you shut down the computers for air traffic, you've got a problem. This is called critical infrastructure. It is part of Homeland Security to advise institutions on how to secure their systems. That's their job. We've been saying for well over 10 years that election systems are critical infrastructure, and finally they're agreeing with us. Now, we need to watch what they're doing. If they start saying, we're going to give you the machines that you're going to vote on, then I've got a problem with that. But right now, all I've seen is to say, we're going to offer some advice on how to secure this system, starting with registration systems. So, yeah, I want to watch them. But frankly, as long as they stick to doing their job and doing it honestly, I am.
Yeah.
California does its own testing.
I know, but he's ahead of the testing.
They're not going to control the testing. They're going to test the security aspect or suggest how to do it. But the testing and development of standards for the other 49 states will be defined by the Election Assistance Commission. They will still conduct their own testing. And I don't care who develops what system. I don't care if it's open source developed by DOT. You want to audit that system every election, and you want to audit it thoroughly. Just assume that the KGB, the NSA, Trump Industries, whatever wrote the program, make that assumption, start from there, and then you audit it. That's our final line of security. We cannot forget that.
Could you go back to that part that I thought I heard you say about truckloads of ballots being delivered, and are these mail-in ballots?
Mail-in ballots.
So somebody can then return them? Could you flesh that out a little bit, and how is this not a recipe for massive fraud?
It is a recipe for massive fraud. That's why we opposed it. We tried very hard, AB 1921. Current law as it exists now says that only members of the family or household can bring somebody else's vote by mail ballot in, and they have to put their name on there. Now they could, I've looked at it, at least in Costa County, they put in Santa Claus, and nobody's been going to check. With the new law, 1921, anybody can bring in any number of ballots, truckloads. And there are no questions asked. You don't have to sign in and say, I brought in 5 truckloads of ballots. Yeah, this is an open invitation to large-scale fraud, large-scale ballot harvesting, and something else, one issue I wanted to bring up quickly. This is a theory now. Thank you, Bev Harris, if you're listening. She came up with the initial idea. I came up with the word automated forgery. One of the things you're going to want your county teams to do for us now, find out by county who is sending out the vote by mail ballots for your county, who's printing them, who's sending them out. If one group has blank ballots, blank envelopes, addresses, and copies of the signature, they can print on the envelope whatever they want. If nobody's checking them, you have automated forgery. And on top of it, we have get out the vote efforts that people call up and say, are you voting today? So people say, well, I need somebody to drive me, fine. So they go drive me. But some people say, no, I'm not going to vote. Oh, you just found out who's not going to check to see if the ballot was received. And you go vote for them. This is a theory. We need you people to go out and see if this constellation of possibilities is being abused. So that's some homework for you.
Jim Shopooth, thank you so much for the hard work and dedication that your colleagues have put into this. It's going to take me a while to digest everything you've shared with us today. I just want to say that after almost 3 weeks of solid observing in the county clerk's office in Mendocino County, I should not be left with so many questions and doubts. I feel like after, you know, all the hours I put in, I should feel assured that our votes are being counted. And exactly the opposite has occurred. I have a lot of questions about the process. And maybe you can answer some of them. One of the specific...
Let's do that offline because I'm out of time. It's complicated. You have state law, you have state regulations, especially new ones being written in the future. You have rules for the machines and the certification document, and then you have new procedures.
So just one question before we leave, please. So we observed 11-to-1 votes for Bernie Sanders. What came out of the machines, the tabulating machines, was very different So what the county clerk told us is that she updates information into her SMS system, which is transferred to the Secretary of State, and that she sets up the code. And she called it programming the tabulating computers, but it clearly they're already programmed. But she enters some kind of code into them, setting it up for the precincts before the ballots are to get through. So my question is, who creates that code? Who writes that code?
What they're doing is two different levels of code. There's the stuff that programmers run and generally make the system work, and then the registrars sit down and put in really a database in which precincts are which candidates running in which races. You have to get all that into, they have to teach the central election management system, they have to teach that system how that's set up. And then that system will go off into a different precinct and say, okay, this precinct, you should have these ballots.
Right, but I can't see that. You're telling me that, but I don't really know what the code accomplishes. I understand that's part of it. But
you can't see that now with the
open. Right, the code.
Yeah, you can't see it. You can't see it now.
You know, technical savvy to respond to the information sent to the Secretary of State to issue the code that's then entered into the tabulating machine. So that's one of my favorite questions.
It's not a code, and this is why we're in open source, so that you can look at it and know one company owns it. Last point, I hope it became clear. 3 or 4 of us, or if Donald, stand up for a second. Donald got the Voting Rights Task Force started. And Meg stood up for a second. She supported the United States Superiors from the point of Sacramento to the initiatives of non-working. Those on internet voting, she shows up. Decisions are made by those who show up. Thank you.
Jim Soper, Voting Rights Task Force. Great job. We got coming up Dr. Barbara Simon of Verified Voting. Very important discussion on elections and registration security. While she comes forward, Jonathan and I have books in the back. This is a shameless plug for mine, Strip and Flip Selection of 2016. I opened it to a random page. We tried to keep track of the importance of history. January 2nd, 2007, the Free Press reported that there had been a 26.48 undervote in the heavily African-American communities of Cuyahoga County in the midterm election. The expected rate of undervote, 3%. The machines delivered 26.48. 27% of the ballots with no vote. Black candidate for state auditor, up by 10 points, loses after massive undervote in the largest city in Ohio. That's why these machines are so important. Again, here's another race, that state auditor's race, 94,000 missing votes that were expected. But on the positive side, January 27, 2007, first felony convictions were handed down against two Cleveland poll workers stemming from the Ohio 2004 presidential election. Cuyahoga County prosecutors said the poll workers rigged, and that's a quote, rigged the recount. Also as a result of that, 2 weeks later, February 6th, Michael Vu, director of the Cuyahoga County Board of Elections, resigned over the handling of Ohio's 2004 election and vowed to go to California and plague the people there with dirt. Well, that part's not in the book. Says Dr. Barbara Simon. Is she here? All right. As she gets better. But verified voting. So the book has the highlights of these really strange encounters where there's missing votes. And recall, they purged from the voting rolls, deregistered a quarter of all the voters in the city of Cleveland prior to the 2004 election. So very important that these voter rolls are in fact protected. So as soon as Dr. Simon's ready, she'll let us know. But again, the highlights of, we've distilled it all into exciting bullet points. We can trace the history of the movement. Dr. Barbara Simon, a pleasure to have you here.
Trying to figure out how to get my slides to work since we're plugging books. I also wrote a book called Broken Ballots, Will Your Vote Count? I didn't bring enough, I only brought a couple books today, so I can't really put them on the table there, but you can buy them on Amazon. So, there. Yes, please, next. So, this
is book makes me available to independent bookshops.
I'm sorry, what?
Yes, independent bookshops.
It was published by Chicago University Press, so my guess is you can get it from them too. I don't know if you consider them an independent bookseller. I would like to have more booksellers carrying it, quite frankly. If you know someone who would like to carry it, tell me about it afterwards. There are three major issues that have me concerned about this election. Well, there are a lot, but three in particular. One is the electronic voting machines, the second is the voter registration databases, and the third is internet voting. And David Dill will cover internet voting, so I shall talk about the first two topics. I don't know to what extent I'm covering old ground here. There are some people who know this stuff in their sleep, and there are some people, I think, who are just coming on board, so if you'll be patient with me, those who know it in your sleep, I'm going to review some fairly fundamental notions. So my background is computer science. Most of the people involved with voting are computer scientists, although not all. And it was the computer scientists who basically started, pretty much led the fight initially against paperless voting machines. And we did because of this slide. We know that computers are not perfect, people might think that voting software would be easy because it's just tabulating yes or no, and so you don't need a lot of software, but in fact, a lot of the software in these machines is very complicated because they have to work in every state, in every district, for a variety of different approaches, like there could be straight party voting, there could be rotations such as we've had in California, with the recall of Brent Davis, remember how confusing that was? There can be situations where you have vote for 3 out of 5. So because the way we vote in this country is so complicated and so non-uniform, the software can be very complicated, very large, very complicated. And when you have a large piece of software, for sure you're going to have software bugs. And to argue that point, I just mentioned that major software vendors like Apple and Microsoft have to send out periodic bug fixes, a number of which are security fixes. And the reason they have to do this is because it's such a hard problem. If it were an easy problem, we would solve it. So that's one of the reasons why we don't trust paperless voting machines for sure. Also, we have to worry about hidden malware in machines. Now again, I think people who haven't been involved with dealing with large software programs might think, well, you can just find it because it's not supposed to be there. But finding hidden malware is equivalent to the problem of finding software bugs. If it were easy to find software bugs, it would be easy to find hidden malware. It's not easy to do either if malware is thoroughly hidden. So that's another concern. So the fact is that software machines could impact election outcomes. So the question is, how did we get to where we are today? And Florida 2000, of course, generated a lot of issues. And we heard so much about the hanging chads. Well, what happened in Florida 2000 is that the paper, in many people's minds, was the culprit. And it wasn't the paper that was the culprit. It was the technology, the way the paper was used, that was the culprit. And in fact, I would even go farther than that, because I voted in Palo Alto in 2000 on these machines, these punch card machines. There were no problems there. In places in Florida, the trays that held the chads were not empty. And when it's not empty, when you try pushing in, it may not go all the way through. So many of these situations, they were not properly maintained. It was also not a good technology because it was hard to verify your vote. You hold up this ballot, you've got these punches. And in many cases, you can't verify that you voted for the candidate you meant to. So it wasn't a good technology. But it wasn't because it was paper. It was because of the design of the technology. But actually, it wasn't until Florida 2002 that Congress decided to do something about this. And so almost $4 billion for the B was allocated to purchase new voting systems under the Help America Vote Act. This money was allocated before we had adequate standards, testing, and of course there were no requirements about the software being open versus secret, as people had been talking about, or proprietary. And there was no accountability of vendors for vendors. There still is no accountability, so far as I know, for flaws in software or hardware. Now, one of the problems is that a lot of people went out and bought these machines because all of a sudden large sums of government money were made available, and election officials wanted to be, you know, in there first with the newest and best, because that's what they were being told. So large sums of money was spent buying these machines. There isn't money anymore. These machines are very old, most of them. In many cases, software is no longer being maintained by the vendor, and they are basically repressed and used by date. And the age of these machines was a major cause of long lines in 2012, and it's likely to repeat in 2016. So I just want to briefly review the kinds of voting systems that we have in this country. At this point, computers are used almost everywhere. And for polling place voting, which is, by the way, I think is the best kind of voting possible, there are, again, two types of machines. They're what are called direct recording electronic. What that means is you directly record your vote on the machine. Typically it's a touchscreen machine. The machine records and counts your vote. So those are called DREs. The early ones, most of the early ones that came out were paperless. We complained a lot. This was sort of the beginning of verified voting, where we talked about having to have a voter verified paper audit trail, and we kind of naively thought that they would do something reasonable. In fact, these machines, the next generation of machines with paper that came out, had continuous roll thermal printed paper, which is very hard to count. It's very hard for the voter to verify, and some of them used particularly bad design. If it's not properly treated, it'll fade. This is like the paper you get in the gas station, the receipt you get in the gas station. And as you know, if you leave them out in the sun, they fade. Well, that's the kind of paper that's used. So these DREs were badly engineered to begin with, and I think I'll talk more about that. And the add-ons of the voter verified paper audit trail were also badly engineered, so at least they weren't consistent. Then there are paper ballots, which is what we advocate. And here in California, as you know, I'm sure, we have paper ballots where you connect the two sides of a broken arrow for the candidates of your choice. Other places will fill in an oval like taking an SAT. I think probably all of us here are taking that. And then I think there may be one or two other variations of the theme, but it's basically taking an SAT. And then these ballots are put into a scanner. The scanner will record and tabulate the vote. The third kind, of course, then there's also remote voting. And I personally am not a fan of remote voting, speaking only for myself, which is not a position of verified voting, because remote voting opens the door for voter coercion, vote buying, and so on. Anyway, with mail-in ballots, they're paper. Typically, they should be paper, and then they're scanned at a central location by anyone who scans that has a computer inside of it. Then there's also internet voting, which is email or web-based, which is insecure. As I say, David Jefferson will cover that. So again, I want to talk a little bit about the history, and I imagine everyone here is sort of devolved, right? I mean, they're sort of notorious. They became the poster child for these voting machines through a series of unfortunate incidents from their perspective. So in February 2003, the old software was discovered and opened a website by Bev Harris, who was mentioned earlier. There were software patches written at the last minute for systems used in the 2002 midterm. This was the first time The depots have been used in Georgia, and I think maybe the first time, I'm not positive, but I think it may be the first time it was used in a federal election. And that election saw a couple of upsets. Senator Max Cleveland was ahead in the polls, but he lost. The Democratic senator and the Democratic governor also lost. There was no independent oversight of this system. There was no independent oversight of the software. And in fact, there were patches being written at the last minute, actually. Somebody in Canada was mailing them to Georgia. Now, I know enough about computers to know whenever you bring out a new system, people are frantically making fixes at the end to get it to run right. I mean, these things, you know, software is complicated. So it's quite possible that these last minute fixes were completely on the up and up, and they were simply trying to fix bugs in the software and to get the thing to work properly. It's also possible it wasn't. And what's frustrating is that we will never know. There was no way then to check it, and there's certainly no way now because that original software is long gone. So we just don't know if that election was properly counted or not. We don't know.
With proper protocol, a lot of those fixes were done without appointments, and the election officials themselves were quite surprised that people showed up to fix stuff they didn't know was broke.
The comment is that all of these fixes were made without proper appointment. As I said, I can't tell if those fixes were being made because there were bugs in the software and they were trying to fix them. There's no way to know why they were being made because there was no oversight and there was no accountability. That's the point I'm making. I'm not making accusations, I'm simply observing we don't know. Another thing that helped Diebold to gain notoriety is a comment by the head of Diebold, Walden Odell, saying that he was committed to help, you know, Ohio deliver its electoral votes to the president next year, to Odell's Republican. I think this was a very unwise comment for him to have made. It doesn't mean that he was actually trying to rig the election, but it certainly made people concerned. In addition, there have been multiple studies, independent studies and state-sponsored studies, that have found major security problems in these machines. For example, in 2006, a group in Princeton showed how to plant the virus on Diebold paperless DREs, which is spread by removable memory card and could be used during an election. This is still on YouTube, so you can go look at it. Anyone can go look at it and see how to do it. They didn't make this posting with the expectation that people would be rigging elections. They made this posting with the expectation that people would get rid of damn machines. But that hasn't happened in many places. So I just point out that in the 2006 election, these Diebold DREs were used by over 10% of voters. So Diebold got out of the voting machine business. As I say, they got some really bad press. But a number of their DREs are still in use. All of Georgia in this election is going to be voting on Diebold paperless DREs that we know how to rig. Now, in some cases, you can say, well, it doesn't matter because we know how Georgia is going to go. But actually, we don't. Georgia seems to be a state that's in contention this year. So what happens in Georgia might actually, conceivably, decide the presidential election. Conceivably. So this is, I trust this is disturbing to all of you. It's certainly disturbing to me. I want to point out that Diebold is not unique. They were just the ones who got the bad press. So in 2007, Secretary of State Bowen in California, that she ran on this, did a top-to-bottom review of all of the voting systems that had been in use, that were in use in California at the time. And by the way, she was only able to do this because of some earlier efforts made by Kevin Shelley, her predecessor, Secretary of State. This review, which brought in independent experts, revealed very troubling flaws in these machines. And just to quote from Matt Graves, who's a computer scientist who was one of the leaders, he said, "We found significant deep-rooted security weaknesses in all three vendors' software." There are three major vendors at the time. "It should now be clear that the red team, because they somehow cheated, but rather because the built-in security mechanisms they were up against simply don't work properly. There was a pervasive lack of good security engineering across all three systems." And we were voting on these systems. Another example of what happens with paperless versus paper, in Carteret County, North Carolina, in an election some years ago. Almost 4,500 votes were lost in early voting. We know they were lost because the machine that was tabulating them only went up to a certain number of votes that it stored, and then it stopped storing them, but it didn't have an error message. So we know how many people signed in to vote, and we know that the difference between the number of votes on that machine and the number of people who signed in was about 4,500. And the Agricultural Commission race, which is one of the statewide races, was separated by fewer votes than the number of missing votes, 2,287 to be precise. There were multiple attempts to rehold the election. Various legal suggestions were thrown up by the courts. So finally, the person who was ahead in the election collected a series of affidavits from people who had gone to vote and not had their vote counted, saying they voted for him. And because he got enough of these affidavits, a judge declared him the winner. So far as I know, that's the only race in which the winner is declared by affidavits. That machine was the Unelect Patriot, and that's still in use in Virginia, which is one of the swing states. By contrast, in Pottawatomie County, Iowa, that's tricky to say, in a Republican primary, there were very bizarre results. A young man, I think a high school student or something, did exceedingly well, and everybody knew he shouldn't. And because they had paper ballots, they were able to go back and look, and they discovered that because of rotations that were being made in the sheet but not taken into account when the ballots were tabulated, the results were all shifted. So they were able to recount with the paper ballots and get the right winners. But that's only because there was paper. If it had been a paperless machine, there would have been nothing they could have done. And getting back to Virginia, there's a nice story from Virginia where the win vote, paperless DRE, was crashing in the Virginia midterms in 2014. And basically, they figured out that people were going in with their iPhones and downloading music, and it was interfering with the machine. The reason it was doing that is that it had Wi-Fi. Voting machine had Wi-Fi. And in addition to that, the unchangeable encryption key was ABCDE, which is a very hard one to think about. Somebody wishing to mess with the election could download the database, change votes, and upload them. And it also ran on Windows CE 3.0, which has had no security updates since 2007, and for that, the password is ADMIN. It was decertified by Virginia after this election when they went in with their security people and discovered that the machines were incredibly vulnerable, but it had been used by 568 precincts since the early 2000s. We don't know. We don't know if any of the elections were changed by people rigging this easily riggable machine. As a colleague of ours said, Jeremy Epstein is the worst voting machine ever. Worse than Dougal, but... So as a result of the long lines, President Obama commissioned a bipartisan panel to look at what created the long lines in 2012. There were some interesting results of that from that panel. One of the things they talk about the impending crisis in voting technology, talking about these DREs. The machines are now reaching the end of their natural life cycle, and no comparable federal funds are in the pipeline to replace them. And by the way, that's still the case. They recommend that auditing the voting equipment must be conducted after each election, and data concerning machine performance must be publicly disclosed. Now, you can't audit the machine unless you've got something to audit. That means paper. So you need paper to audit the machine, and the audit should be done manually because the whole idea of these audits is to check on the computers. So you don't want a computer checking on the computer, you want people checking on the computer. And in particular, the commission recommended something called risk-limiting audits, which I'm going to talk about in a little bit. So the idea is, after an election, we want to make sure that the computers performed correctly, because we know they might not. Now, California has this interesting law since 1965, whereby 1% of all precincts randomly selected should conduct a manual recount. So this was way ahead of its time when this law was passed. However, people didn't really understand what this meant. So, for example, if that didn't say anything about escalation. What happens if you start doing this recount and you discover problems? In fact, what is a problem? Even that is not defined, right? So it doesn't say what to do. I think when the people wrote the law, they just assumed that if there were all these problems, there would be a total recount, but that's not in the law. What we want, what verified voting has been pushing for, what I've been pushing for, what David Jefferson has been pushing for, and all my colleagues, and I know what Jim has been pushing for, is evidence-based elections. We need to be able to verify that the computer-declared winners actually won. And the only way is to check the paper ballot viewed by the voter. So, again, doing these post-election ballot audits, 1% manual recount in many cases is too much, in some cases it's far too little. It depends on how close the race is. So if it's very, very close, a small number of ballots could flip the results. That means you have to check a lot of them to make sure that there aren't problems with even just a very few of them. Whereas if it's very far apart, you may not have to check very many. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So using that notion, Philip Stark, who at the time was chairman of the Statistics Department at Berkeley and now is an associate dean, looked at this problem, the first statistician who's ever looked at how to do audits. And he came up with something called risk-limiting audits. The idea is you say beforehand how much confidence you want to have in that the election results are correct. And then you look at how close the results are. And depending on that, you know how many ballots you have to start looking at. They should be randomly selected. Ideally, you would do it at the individual ballot level, but sometimes that's not easy, especially with some of the machines that we're using. So you may have to do it in batches. There are various tweaks on this, but the idea is you start off with a certain number of ballots that you look at, and you keep tabs. So we know what happened, what a problem means now. A problem is if a ballot says I voted for candidate A, but the computer thinks I voted for candidate B, that's two. If I say I voted for candidate A and it doesn't show anything, that's one. Make sense? So one is not to have my vote counted, recorded, and two is to have my vote recorded for the wrong candidate. Yeah? So the idea is that you start looking at these ballots and you check, how these ballots compare with what's in the voting machine. And depending on what happens, you continue looking. If you find problems, you continue looking. And look until either you've convinced yourself that the results are correct or you've done a total manual recount. So I have to go quickly here. So let me just say the commission's results were widely ignored. There are five states that are entirely paperless: Georgia, Delaware, Louisiana, New Jersey, and South Carolina. There are 10 states that are partially paperless, and of those 10 states, Pennsylvania and Virginia are swing states, which means that there's no way to do a meaningful recount in 15 states. And even in those states which have paper, a number of them do not conduct adequate post-election ballot audits. So what we should do in the short run, provide emergency paper ballots for all DREs, whether or not they have paper. Poll workers should be instructed to use these emergency ballots when the lines get long. And voters should be reassured that the emergency ballots will actually be counted. So I'm going to skip along. Long run, get rid of the damn things, you know. And pass laws that require people to look at these paper ballots, because having the paper ballots that are not looked at doesn't really accomplish a lot. So there we go, there's a little. I'm going to go on to voter. I don't have much time for databases, so I'm going to go really fast. You've probably seen the statement from October 7th, where the Director of the National Intelligence, Department of Homeland Security, have said that the Russians are trying to hack into our elections. Again, we have these voter registration databases because of Florida 2000 and 2002 with Help America Vote Act, because Democrats complained, I think correctly, that voters were wrongly removed from the voting rolls, and Republicans complained that non-voters, such as undocumented immigrants or former felons illegally voted, they got together and required that all states move to online voter registration databases statewide by 2006. Again, no testing requirements, no tracking, no vendor accountability, no federal standards, including security. In Washington State, recently, a candidate for the Secretary of State discovered a backdoor in the statewide registration database. It's been fixed, but I want to point out that she did that without a full-fledged security audit, and who knows. Arizona-Illinois databases have been hacked. I'm sure you've heard about this. Again, probably Russians. 20 states have been targeted with probes. Department of Homeland Security has offered to help states try to check their database security. About 20 states have accepted that offer. Where are the rest of them? So why should we worry? Voter registration databases contain party affiliation. It could be easy to do a selective attack by deleting names or changing addresses. And this, if this were done, it would result in chaos at the polls. Voters would be given provisional ballots, presumably, but then there's the question, if the databases have been hacked, if the database has been hacked, how do you verify that the voter was actually in that database? You need to be able to go back to a version of the database that had that voter's name in it, and we don't know if election officials are keeping these databases long-term. We just don't know. So this is a concern, and by the way, in terms of changing the address, this is especially a concern in those states which have voted by mail, and there are now three of them. Because if you change the address, you won't get the ballot. You will realize you hadn't gotten the ballot, and I'm sure that people will get the ballot at the last minute, but again, this is going to cause chaos. So I'm going to skip over this. We need to basically provide backup. The databases need to be backed up frequently. They shouldn't be written over with new backups. And we don't know if it's already too late. We should encourage voters to check that they are registered, and I would say check repeatedly. There should be a paper copy of the local voter registration database at each polling place, and there should be a sufficient number of provisional ballots provided as backup, because hopefully those ballots will be counted. In the long run, there's a lot that we can do. I won't go over this right now, but we can talk about it later if you want, or David could also discuss it. I just want to say that voting is a national security issue. It should be declared a part of the critical infrastructure. This is something we've been working on in verified voting. There's been a lot of pushback, but I mean, when you look at what's going on now, this truly is a national security issue. So there's our website. Verified Voting is the only national organization working on election integrity. We've got a lot of information about how the different states vote for the different kinds of voting machines, internet voting, and so on. So I hope you'll check this out.
Dr. Barbara Simon, Verified Voting. I'll indulge my role as MC and ask her a question I'm interested in. The Everest study in Ohio that came up with a backdoor and also many different ways. What's the security look like if you can outsource the vote to a vendor in Chattanooga, Tennessee, in this case they claim the Ohio supercomputers had failed. Any thoughts on that Everest study?
Well, I don't think the Everest study addressed the outsourcing particularly. They just looked at the voting systems, as I understand it.
But she did admit in the press conference, Jennifer Bruner, that was a, quote, back door, and she later released, in a lawsuit, that entire architectural map was released, which showed where the vote was counted.
Well, of course, we know that the Everest study confirmed what the top-to-bottom review study showed, which is that these systems are insecure. I just want to make one quick comment. This is not directly to your comment, to your question, but I wanted to make this point. There's been a lot of talk, certainly I've heard people expressing the desire for open source software as opposed to proprietary software. Now, I happen to think open source software is a good idea. I mean, by open source, we mean public, so that it's available for people to look. But it's not a panacea, it won't solve the problem. Because, first of all, even with open source software, there could be hidden malware that we don't find. Or we don't know what the software is that's being run on the machine on election day. So open source is a good idea, but it's not the end all and be all. What we really need is paper ballots and sound post-election ballot audits that are required by law. That's what we need. If we have that, it won't matter who wrote the software, because we have the paper ballots.
Thank you. pleasure to see you again. It's been a while. And I want you to know my favorite site is that site.
Thank you.
I knock on it every day, you know, looking at it, putting the entire volume, what we're doing. And I just want to ask you one simple question. I guess you just did a recent update to the site because, you know, I saw where the state of Maine is now 100% using digital imagery. Maryland, I didn't know that to you guys. I guess just did a recent update in the last month. You know, I thought in my state there was only 5 counties that had digital imagery for ballots. It turned out that there was 11 after the update, and which is just a really pleasant surprise because, you know, it seems to me that because of Clear Ballot and other companies are moving into digital imagery that is exactly the copy of the ballot and using Dr. Stark's method, like you said, and having elections that are evidentiary has transformed me from an election integrity activist to an election transparency activist. Because elections aren't any good unless they are, well, one, transparent, taking that black box, making it into a transparency box. Two, they have to be trackable because of chain of custody, and the CVR in these new systems is second to none. And then, of course, they're publicly verifiable. Ballot images are a public record, and that can be done, put online by precinct. People can download that. My question to you, have you looked into any of this, and how do you feel about the new ballot imagery, like Clear Ballot, ESSDS series? Because 40% of the country right now is producing ballot images, and thank you for all you do.
Well, thank you for your very nice comments. My understanding, and I hope somebody will correct me if I have this wrong, is that Clear Ballot automates the counting. Is that, David, is that, do I have that right? Do you know?
Not a short answer.
What?
Not a short answer.
Right, well, maybe you'll talk about it. I mean, because one of the points that we are always making is that you need, and that Philip Stark makes, is that you need to manually count the ballots.
Yes.
And to the extent that has been automated, that could be a concern because, again, you have a computer doing the counting. And I mean, maybe someone else will expand on that.
Thank you. I could not agree with you more that voting needs to happen on paper ballots and that the computers, the machines, are hurting the transparency too much. So they need to be taken out. And that's not enough. Because elections are called on elections night, let's face it. And so the mail-in ballots, I'm concerned about mail-in ballots that are arriving on or after Elections Day, and provisional ballots, which are being left out. It's almost like no matter what happens, they're never counted. It's important that we're putting out all this effort to find out and to follow up on what's happening with those ballots. But by then, elections have been called. And candidates can see, and then it's all a wash. Nothing ever happens with that. So I'm really concerned about having the ballots, as many as possible, counted on elections night. So my father tells me in the old days, each precinct counted their paper ballots by hand, and that number was then communicated to the central clerk's office, and everything was done. Wrapped up, finished on elections night. So I think we need to return to precincts and to doing things more locally so we don't have these huge piles and then we're told, oh, we can't possibly process all of these ballots without all of these machines. That's not so. We just need to break it up and make it small, in my opinion. And it seems like we need an attorney for every county, at least, when we have an amazing candidate like Bernie Sanders, because we need to have things challenged on Elections Day, so that's something. I don't know if like we need an Elections Day task force or something like that.
Well, so there are a number of points you made in your comments, and I'm going to try to remember to address them. If I forget, let me remind you. In terms of manually counting all the ballots, I think that horse is out of the barn. Our ballots are so complicated in this country that I just don't see that as an option, as a feasible option in most cases. I've actually worked as a poll worker in Canada, where the ballots were manually counted. There were, in this case, two questions on the ballot. Normally, there's only one, namely a member of parliament. There were two. So they had two separate pieces of paper, and they sorted them at each table and counted them that night. Nobody could leave until the votes were reconciled with the number of people who had gone to vote. All the ballots were counted for. They did a great job. We can't do this in this country. I mean, the California ballot is enormous. If that sort of thing were done in California, people would be up through the next morning counting. It's just too hard. We have too much on our ballots. I mean, I think we vote for too many things, quite frankly. I think we make our ballots too complicated. But because we have that, I just don't see us going back to manual counts. Also, I want to defend the use of computers. I've just been knocking them. But computers actually can contribute as well. The point is they have to be used properly. If you do computerized counting with a manual check, you have two things, two ways of looking at it. Computers are very good at counting things, as long as they don't screw up. So I actually think computers are a positive addition to our election if they are used properly. The problem is, when they were first introduced with these DREs, they weren't used properly, and that's the difficulty. We need to use the technology appropriately. I don't know, is there some, yes, the count, the reports, the provisional ballots and so on. I think what you're talking about is really the media. The media, it's the media that's pressuring election officials to report results. If we're going to have post-election ballot audits, which we need to have, the results should not be finalized until after those audits. And nobody should concede until after those audits, as far as I'm concerned. But that doesn't mean they won't. I mean, you know, it's up to the candidate.
Hi, I'm Paul Thomas with Election Justice. You may have seen the report we put out this year, on the primaries. But you're addressing some issues that are very dear to that report and what I'm concerned about, and that it may be too particular for you, but I spoke with Jim Soper about what the structure, relationships between county voter registration databases and the state level voter registration. Do you have any insight into the network connections, if there are real-time connections and so on?
No, I don't have any insight, and I have to confess, I don't know a lot about it. In fact, I don't know how many people know what's really going on nationally with these voter registration databases, because there's no central repository of information that I'm aware of. And as I say, there have been no standards, there's no testing, there's no oversight. It's really not a good arrangement. So I'm sorry, I can't think. Maybe someone else here knows the answer, I just don't know.
Kobach, the Secretary of State in Kansas, that's at least been spread to 25 states. And it concentrates on minorities, overwhelmingly Asian, Hispanic, and blacks. There's like 250,000 William Jacksons, which they're supposedly double voting, but they're not using a match of middle names or date of birth, which makes it very suspect.
Well, what you're talking about is what election officials do as opposed to the databases. So I've just been trying to address the technology.
Thank you.
Hi, thank you. I'm Alice Chan, and I have been monitoring elections in Sonoma County for the past 10 years. And I was really glad to see on your slides there that you mentioned that there's no escalation. I'm talking about the 1% manual tally, but there are no standards for escalating and including a larger sample. And I've been asking that question of our registrar ever since I started. Because what I saw them doing in the manual tally is if the ballot did not agree with what the machine spit out, they would just look for voter intent and move on. And there were times when it looked to me like there were a lot of mistakes, and that might indicate problems with the tally. But there was no standard for escalating and taking a larger sample. Now, what I really think that this is an important issue that should be taken up, and possibly it's just through some changes in the election code. And I'm not sure that the risk would go to that kind of audit.
Yes, I would urge your election officials to contact Philip Starr or contact Verified Voting. about conducting risk remedying audits because I think that will deal with your issues. It will extend the audit until you've been able to find out who really won with almost complete certainty.
Yeah, I was just wondering if you could speak to, I find that there's a big gap between the stripping and the flipping community, and I often notice that a lot of people who look at voting rights and stripping don't want to touch the flipping because it's, you know, too conjectural or conspiratorial, and then I also find that a lot of election integrity activists don't focus at all on these huge voter purges that involve millions of votes. We haven't talked about any of the voter, the state voter suppression laws that have been being passed all over the country. And I just feel like there's a huge organizing opportunity between the two different aspects, especially around these issues like voter registration databases, where that's where we're going to see a lot of like, minorities and people being purged. But I just wonder if you can speak to kind of these two movements coming together.
I'm not sure what you mean by stripping and flipping.
Oh yeah, so the flipping part being the election integrity aspects, the computerized voting, the ability for votes to be changed or dropped and things of that nature, things that happen more on the counting side, and the stripping being the you know, voter purges, the barring felons from voting, voter ID laws, trying to keep people from voting, voter suppression, that nature.
Okay, well, one thing I want to say, verified voting it focuses on the technology, not on, I mean, obviously there are implied policy issues with technological decisions, but our focus is on technology, not on things like voter like purges. I mean, what we want to do is to have accountability, accuracy, reliability, security, and so on. And we want to make the systems as good as possible so that if you have honest election officials, you'll be able to verify the results. If you've got dishonest election officials, it's very hard to guarantee anything. But I just want to make a personal comment, and this is, verified voting is nonpartisan, first of all. I want to be really clear. When I wrote this book, Broken Ballots, I did the chapter on voter registration. And in doing that chapter, I went back and read a lot about felon disenfranchisement, something I hadn't really thought about before. And I was really appalled by what I learned. And I think it's a fair statement to say that felon disenfranchisement laws were basically created after the Civil War to keep African Americans from voting. And if you look at states that have the most severe felon disenfranchisement laws, those are southern states, or states with large African American populations. I personally, and again, I'm not speaking for verified voting, I personally think that there should be an all-out effort to eliminate all disenfranchisement laws. I think anyone who's a citizen should be able to vote.
All right,
well,
thank you. Just one last question. With these poll books, which famously melted down in Hamilton County, Ohio, because they couldn't download the software, will you be branching into that area as these e-poll books, which are computerized, proliferate?
I grew up in Cincinnati, so I know Hamilton County very well. The question is, if we branch into looking at e-poll books, I think that would be a valuable thing to do. I should point out that verified voting, believe it or not, we don't have a large staff. We operate on a limited budget. Hint, hint, hint. And the more resources we have, the more we'll do.
All right, thank you. Dr. Barbara Simon. I'm Sean online. Why can't I vote online? Answering that question. David Jefferson, computer scientist, Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory.
Okay, so I'm here to talk about online voting and why you don't want to do it. First, I want to tell you a little bit about myself. I am a computer scientist. I've been working in supercomputing and cybersecurity applications for the last 20 years of my career. And I've been deeply involved in the issue of online voting for 17 years, basically as long as anybody in the United States. I've served as a technical advisor to five secretaries of state of California have spoken and written voluminously about this subject, and I am, like Barbara, a board member of Verified Voting and also of the California Voter Foundation, two nonpartisan, nonprofit organizations devoted to secure and transparent elections. All right, but today I want to talk about online voting. Wouldn't it be nice to be able to sit in your living room or in your hotel room or on the beach and to be able to vote online in a public election? The answer is, of course, it would be nice. Everybody would like to be able to do that. Not just for the convenience of being able to vote from home, but because you can get information about candidates and issues in the same medium on which you vote. It's a very attractive prospect. But the message that I want to deliver you today, in no uncertain terms, is that the entire computer and network security community, virtually unanimously around the world, says, no, it's not possible to secure an online election satisfactorily, not now with current technology, and not with any technology in the foreseeable future. So our message is, please don't expect it, please don't ask for it. And please support us when we tell you this is a bad idea for the foreseeable future. The people shown here, Professor David Hill, Barbara Simons, who you just heard from, Bruce Schneier, MIT Professor Ron Revest, Princeton Professor Ed Felton, etc. All these people are national and international experts in elections and voting security, and they've all contributed to the debate and the discussion of online elections. So Barbara just told you that election security is an aspect of national security, and of course with my national security background I want to emphasize that. But in particular, now more than ever, finally after a decade of trying to deliver this message, we can see this. The Department of Homeland Security and the Director of National Security just this week jointly issued a statement that you've all seen, I'm sure, that there have been Russian nation-state attacks on U.S. election-related services, particularly on the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee and on the Democratic National Committee, and probably also responsible for the voter registration database attacks in Illinois and Arizona and several other states not yet named. So it's not just domestic political partisans about whom we have to worry when it comes to the security of online elections. We have to worry about a kid from Nigeria, and we have to worry about rival nation states. It's a very serious national security issue, in my view. All right, but the title of this talk was, If I Can Shop Securely Online, Why Can't I Vote Online? And if this talk is normally about an hour and 10 minutes, I've got to squeeze it down. So I would at this point list a long table of the security and privacy requirements for e-commerce and the security and privacy requirements for voting in a public election. And I would show you how in each case the security and privacy requirements for voting are much more strict and difficult to achieve than they are for e-commerce. That's why it's possible to be able to say, well, it is safe to bank and shop online, but it is not, and it isn't going to be any time in the future that we can see safe to vote online. I'm not going to be able to go through that table of comparisons in this half hour, but I will detail the specific cyber threats that we are worried about when it comes to online voting. So is online voting much like shopping? Only superficially. They are both transactions where you identify yourself, you make your choices, at the end you say, click, make my choice official, you know, complete my purchase, complete my vote. But except for that superficial sequence of events, nothing about the back-end security and privacy processes are the same. Let me note, first of all, that people are used to saying that shopping and banking online are safe. And that's pretty much true for consumers, for the buyers, for you, the public. It is not true for the merchants and the banks. They lose billions of dollars a year in fraudulent transactions. 1 to 2% of all online credit card transactions are fraudulent. There is a huge amount of money that the banks and credit card companies spend to combat fraud. They still only can get it down to about 1 to 2% of fraud. A 1 or 2% fraud rate could not conceivably be tolerated if those transactions were voting transactions, as I don't have to tell you. All right, now, let me tell you about the specific kinds of internet voting that we are worried about and the specific threats that we're worried about. There are two broad kinds of internet voting. One is email voting, where the ballot and your identification and whatever oath you have to submit with it are appended as an attachment to an email message that you just send to election officials. Email voting. The other is web transaction voting, where you authenticate yourself, then the ballot's presented to you on screen, you make your choices, you check all your choices, and you finally click submit my ballot, and it says thank you for voting. I'm going to talk about the two separately. They are both extremely dangerous, but for different reasons. So people think of email voting as just a different kind of vote by mail. Is email voting like paper mail voting? Well, from a security point of view, no, it is not. The difference is that email voting, or any kind of internet voting, is subject to automated attacks, not just hand attacks, from anywhere on earth, by anyone on earth. A disaffected teenager, a domestic political partisan, or a foreign intelligence agency. You can't say that about paper ballots. If you are mail, if the mail-in paper ballot system is vulnerable to what we call retail fraud, small-scale fraud, by people who are in a position to actually touch those ballots. But not anybody in the world. You can't remotely from Moscow or Peking mess with the mail-in ballot system. Nor can you create a system that can affect thousands or tens of thousands of paper mail-in ballots. But you can do that if the ballots are electronic. Now let me mention the specific vulnerabilities about email, why we reject it entirely as a medium for transmission of ballots. First of all, email and their attachments are not end-to-end encrypted. They may be encrypted link by link, but they are decrypted and re-encrypted every time the email is forwarded. So always somebody, an ISP, for example, has access to your unencrypted email. This is not going to change in the foreseeable future. Even if you did send encrypted mail, and some of us do, the headers cannot be encrypted. Where it's coming from, who it's going to, those have to be in the clear, or the internet protocols themselves wouldn't be able to read the address to which the vote is to be sent. Your name is attached to your ballot sent by email. So all vote privacy is lost. In most states that permit email voting, you're actually required to sign a waiver saying, all right, I know my ballot may not be private, but I'm sending it by email anyway. I personally question the legality of this waiver system, because the privacy of a ballot is not an individual right that's yours to waive, in my view. This is a collective right about the security of the election. It's a right. It's our protection against vote buying and selling, against vote coercion, against pre-counting of ballots. It's not a waivable right, in my view, but some states do it. Anyone who is an IT person in the path that an emailed ballot takes can copy or drop or delay or modify that ballot, and neither the sender nor the receiver can possibly know. Remember, this ballot is in the clear at each point of that along the route that it is forwarded. This particular type of attack was demonstrated by a company called Galois in November 2014. Email attacks are generally undetectable, and if you did detect them, they would be uncorrectable. If the ballot is in the form of a PDF that is sent into the network of the local election official, PDFs are well known for being able to contain malware. So it would be possible to create a phony ballot containing malware that gets into the election system by and through the medium of sending a fake ballot. It's just, email is just a disaster. And I, in my opinion, email voting is probably the most dangerous form of voting ever invented. And I liken it to attaching a $100 bill to a postcard and putting it in a mailbox and expecting the postcard to get, and the $100 bill to get to the other end unmolested. Nonetheless, about 30 states in the United States allow email and or fax voting. I don't think many votes are cast that way. Email voting is clumsy, fax voting is clumsy, it's slow, but in fact, it's legal. And that includes California, which allows fax voting, although not email voting. And when I say fax voting, I lump it with email voting because they have similar vulnerabilities with faxes and email. All right, now the rest of my time I'm going to be talking about web-based voting. Web-based voting is not as bad as email voting, but it's like the difference between jumping off a 1,000-foot cliff and jumping off a 500-foot cliff. They're both way too dangerous to conduct a national security operation like a national election. So there are many kinds of cyber attacks against web-based voting. There are voter identity and authentication attacks, where there are automated attempts to cast votes for either legitimate voters or for impersonated legitimate voters or for phony voters. There are server penetration attacks, where you actually attack the server and take over the server that's collecting or counting the votes. There are ransomware attacks. There are malware attacks against your own smartphone or desktop PC from which you're voting. There are automated buying and selling attacks. There are distributed denial of service attacks. Some of these I'm going to have time to explain. Some of these I'm not. Some of them you may already understand. But I bring them up because in no case of all of these categories of attacks, and each of them is a big family of attacks. It's not just a single, pointed attack. There's a whole family behind each of these bullets. We don't have fundamental solutions to any of them, and we don't see them in the foreseeable future. We now are talking about the computer security community. These problems are foundational and are not going to be solved anytime soon. Before, but attacks that we could see. Ransomware, however, is one of the fastest growing attack modes on the internet now. It's very common now. You don't see it much in the news because people suppress it, but it's an extremely serious and widespread problem, not just growing, but already widespread. Malware attacks. Now I'm talking about attacks on the voters' own computers, okay? At any given moment, somewhere between 10 and 30% of all computers in the world are infected with malware. It's essentially impossible to prevent or even to detect the presence of malware in any kind of general way. Don't even imagine that having antivirus software is protection against malware. I mean, it's certainly not general protection against malware. It may catch some, but there is no way to catch all malware. Malware can modify your vote inside your own computer while you're voting before it's encrypted and sent down the wire to the server at the other end. We have malware that operates like this in the e-commerce world. There's a famous piece of malware called Zeus, which has stolen hundreds of billions of dollars from mostly British consumers and small businesses interacting with their banks, where the malware in the computer steals credentials used to make financial transactions with the bank, and there's absolutely no reason that Zeus could not have been modified to steal voting credentials instead of steal banking credentials. It's really no particular difference. There are many other things malware can do. Malware can just outright prevent you from voting if it doesn't like what else it sees on your computer. For example, it might look at places that you visited with your browser and say, hey, voted, went to that party's voting site a little too many times. I think he's going to vote for that party. I don't want that vote. But malware could make that kind of decision. Malware, that's just suppressing your vote. Malware could actually change your vote. Malware could send your vote to a third party, either against your wishes and subject to coercion, or with your permission and allow you to sell your vote, all, you know, to an automated vote-buying service. Again, we haven't seen these things in the wild, but there's nothing preventing these things. Distributed denial of service attacks. Now, these kinds of attacks have occurred. These are attacks that prevent, that overwhelm the vote server with so much traffic that some resource on the server side is completely saturated, and the server either crashes or becomes incredibly slow, so slow that the voters would all get timeouts or other failures to be able to vote. Their votes would not be able to get through. And you would detect this kind of attack, of course, but that wouldn't help the voters who were unable to vote. This particular kind of attack is about the easiest kind of online attack that there is. There are kits out there. There are people who run businesses doing denial of service attacks for you, for a price, against any IP address you choose. And this has occurred in actual online elections. In the Arizona Democratic presidential primary in the United States in 2000. I don't know why I wrote 1980. It's 2000. The Ontario New Democratic Party leadership election in 2003, and again the same election in 2012, in Hong Kong in 2012. This is a deeply serious attack mode. Now, I'm running out of time here, but there is a fabulous story about a Professor Alex Halderman conducted an attack on a mock election to be held in D.C., in 2010, that was intended to be used in the general election in 2012, remotely from the University of Michigan. He gained total control of that server without the election officials knowing it. He took control of all of the ballots, substituted phony ballots for them, became a complete scandal. This story deserves a 15-minute treatment, which I do not have time to give you, but it's a fabulous story, and we should talk about it offline, or maybe you can look it up. Again, there are 5 or 6 states in the United States that allow web-based internet voting, at least for overseas and military citizens, and 1 state, Alaska, that allows web-based internet voting for all of its citizens in any election. Alaska is unfortunately moving in the wrong direction here, pioneering in the wrong direction. So, my conclusion here. There are fundamental security problems that plague internet voting, and that's internet voting of any kind. It doesn't matter what new curlicue is added to the latest internet voting proposal. We understand internet voting at a foundational level, and there's no strong national remote voter authentication scheme in the United States. There is no general solution to the client-side malware problem, no general solution to a network denial of service attack problem, no general solution to the penetration attack problem, or no meaningful auditability and verifiability because there's no paper trail, as Barbara Simons just mentioned. And I might add, internet voting software is never finished because it has to be constantly under development because the platforms change, the internet changes, the threat space changes, new attacks are discovered all the time. So the answer is, really, for the foreseeable future, we do not want, whatever other problems the voting system has, internet voting is not the answer. Thank you.
All right. Question. There was a famous meltdown. CEIC is one of the companies that has pushed this in Leamington, Ontario. And the other thing, the question of, in Ohio, they're not allowed to upload directly to any central tabulators, but some states actually allowed plugins. Is that an area where you can upload the overseas votes right into the central tabulator? Should we be concerned with that being a
vulnerability as well.
By upload, you mean over the internet?
Yes.
As I said, there is no variation on internet voting whatsoever that is safe. Now, depending upon the exact architecture of it, I would give different criticisms of it. I just gave you general criticisms that apply to all internet voting systems. As soon as you give me an architecture, they usually have additional vulnerabilities on top that I can point to. So, no, there really is no safe way. And believe me, we have looked. We've been looking for 17 years, and the security community has been looking at this for 17 years. Forget what the vendors say. The security community understands these issues. Jim.
Thank you, David, for your talk. I've seen a lot lately a mention of Bitcoin, which is this internet currency that's supposedly hyper-secure, et cetera, and people saying, we need to do our ballots as if they were Bitcoins, and use that kind of security. Would you please explain a bit what that works, how that works, and why it doesn't work? Thank you.
So they're not talking about Bitcoin, the currency. They're talking about, and I'm sorry, I've lost the term. Blockchain protocol. Thank you. They're talking about the blockchain protocol inside Bitcoin and other services as being a potential component of a secure internet voting system. Now, blockchains have interesting properties, but they do not solve any of the problems that I have listed here as the key problems with internet voting. Blockchain does nothing about voter authentication. It does nothing about client-side malware. It does nothing about server penetration attacks. Maybe arguable about that. It certainly does nothing about the distributed denial of service attacks. Blockchains is an interesting technology that is looking for a way to be of service internet voting, but it does not solve the key problems. It solves the easy parts of the problem, like cryptography. Cryptography is another important tool which you would use inside of any internet voting system. And you would use it for encrypted transmission. You may encrypt the ballots for storage on the server and so on. I don't even mention cryptography attacks because those are the easy parts of internet voting. And we don't even bother to mention them. Blockchain is like that. It doesn't solve any of the remaining fundamental problems. So that's why I don't bring it up. Yes, sir.
Thank you, David. I have likened internet voting to what the mafia would call an open city, and regular computerized voting to something like a closed city. And I think for most people, they get, and I'm in violent agreement with you, or non-violent agreement, about internet voting. But it's really important in the advocacy, I think, to be able to pivot so that in speaking about the dangers and the ills of internet voting, we don't in any way seem to be defending the status quo of good old computerized voting, which, while it doesn't have as many of the vulnerabilities as internet voting, is a very closed system, a very proprietary system, where those vulnerabilities are not free-for-all. They're in the hands of some very partisan organizations and outfits that actually do the programming and distribute it. So, while I agree about the internet voting, I think the case against internet voting sometimes almost seems to be defending what we have now. I noticed that at the end you said not to defend what we have now, or some proof of that. I just think that's really important as an emphasis, especially at a time when we seem to be just drifting inexorably to greater and greater and greater computerization. People look at op scans and say, well, that's not even a computer. And it sure as hell isn't.
Well, I completely agree with you. My mission, of course, is to talk about internet voting, but you're right, and as a board member of Verified Voting, I have been involved with dealing with non-internet voting systems since 1999, and I was one of the key players in California on the touchscreen voting task force that Kevin Shelley, as Secretary of State, created, and we created the I believe that task force started the ball rolling in the United States towards requirement of voter verified paper trails as part of precinct voting systems. And so, not to suggest in any way that the precinct voting systems don't have plenty of vulnerabilities and serious problems with them now. I do, however, believe that internet voting, if anything, is much more dangerous, again, because however bad your precinct voting system is, it can't be affected by China. It can't be affected by Russia. And the biggest threat to a precinct voting system is one county wide. That's, unfortunately, much larger threats are possible if a statewide online election should occur. So they're both, that's why I said 1,000 feet, 500 feet, they're dangerous threats at all levels. Yes?
It seems that mainstream media, as well as what you presented at the beginning, the common thought is that their hacks come from Russia. And I looked into this as much as I can on the internet, and I don't see any evidence. I'm wondering if you personally have seen evidence of hacks by Russia.
Well, so this week, the Director of National Intelligence and the Department of Homeland Security specifically blamed the attacks on the DNC and the DCCC on Russia and the Russian government. Now, I accept that, but I also would say that I did an amateur investigation myself, and it took me about three clicks to get from the IP addresses that the FBI had published about a month earlier as being responsible for the attacks on the DNC and the DCCC. About three clicks to get to a website in Russian. Now, that was an amateur and not definitive test, but let me just say there are multiple lines of evidence, which I'm not privy to, which caused the DHS and the DNCC and the Director of National Intelligence to come to that conclusion. Yes?
Okay. Last question. Before lunch.
And I'm going to have to choose one, but I'm just going to, Bev Harris's video on Fraction Magic will be coming out, whereby we understand there's a fractionalization in all the computer software that's generated from global election management systems, and presumably all you'd have to do is put in a program to use that fractionalization, and it really could, the voting machines in the precinct could presumably be affected by that. That's new information, as I understand it, and I'm not a computer scientist, but I understand part of it, and her video will explain it soon. What I wanted to ask you was about QR code and the infrared reading of a QR code in which is embedded the information on a hand. Human readable, hand countable ballot. That's what we're going to get in LA County. And if character recognition software in 10 languages is not up to the task of scanning these ballots, eventually I think this QR code will be voter verification when you stick it under the infrared. And I don't know what the scanner is going to be like, but presumably if it reads that. As a computer scientist, can you explain what infrared reading of a QR code is and to what degree it could be hacked and whether it would be, and at what point the intrusion would be possible? Have you thought about this yet?
Well, certainly. So, first of all, that the Los Angeles system under design has a lot of security professional firepower advising it. They are certainly well aware of the QR codes and the strengths and weaknesses of them. The fact that they are read by infrared as opposed to visible light.
I'll pick up your lunch and come back. Bev Harris should be calling in from Black Box Voting. So quickly, break for lunch.
So, folks, I got your attention. All right, so we've got a tight schedule today. I've got a big mouth off. We've got a tight schedule today. So if you would allow one table at a time to come up. So lunch is $7, $8, and that includes your drink, okay? So Allison can take either a credit card, debit card, or cash, all right? No one will be turned away if we're going to go to your pay. Look for just let us know, okay? And on that note, if you've got a little bit extra to give, maybe somebody that doesn't have money for lunch today, so much, folks. If we could start with this table, thank you.
Break, and we're expecting Bev Harris from Black Fox Voting to call in and talk to us during the lunch hour, so I don't want to end this live feed just so that you guys can be part of that. So give us about 10 minutes and we'll sit down and have Bev Harris join us during the lunch hour, so hang tight.
Thank you.
anything else, Ian, because we're going to get on the Bev Harris call in 5 minutes.
I'll walk around with food to remind people to go get it.
Okay, great. Okay, great. I'll be standing by.
How's it going? People are in the hall here, easily awake. Good thoughts. I think the fraction magic is what's on a lot of people's mind.
Yeah. Yeah, is it been shown up in yet? It's just a draft, but
no.
Is it show the film? I mean, the one
that no. 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 She has not shown it yet. Bev's thing. We have not shown Bev's fraction magic thing. I thought we were not to, so tell her no. The answer is no.
I'm informed that we haven't showed it, that essentially we weren't supposed to show it. Is that correct?
Oh, it was allowed to be shown on the screen, just not posted online.
I mean, I'm sorry to people like
videotape the screen, but I can't post it online. You've got to.
This is not what I do.
That's what we can't do.
Okay. Right. So we will show it, we just will not put it online.
Right, and I don't care if people in the audience film it. I mean, it's just that I don't want it to be a downloadable type of deal or something that you can capture online, because I've got a couple of liability things I've got to fix. They're minor, you know, but.
Yeah, we appreciate that, and it looks like most people are ready to go. So I give the crowd my good friend, the godmother of the whole movement, the one who turned me on with Black Box Voting, your book and your reporting, Bev. So I'm greatly beholden to you. In altering my life and what I write about. So I give you Bev Harris.
Well, Phil, what am I doing here? I thought it was a question and answer period after the film. I guess I'm a little unclear. Did you want me to speak?
We're gonna look at the film a little later. There seemed to have been a misunderstanding, but if you can explain basically what we'll be looking at and why it's important.
Well, we'll be posting the film. It'll probably be late tonight. It'll be on YouTube, and I just had a partially done a draft of it, which I let loose to Jim, so that you guys can get an idea of what's to come. But basically, we did what's impossible, tried to commit to a simple YouTube format that an eighth grader can understand, a table of complex mathematics that comes out of a laptop. And I think we did okay. But basically, here's the issue. We obtained a bunch of files, and I had those files looked at. I transferred them to a guy in 2014, a new guy on the scene, right? From Memphis, and he discovered something that was very, very disturbing in the programs that are used, the GEMS program, which used to be the old Diebold program. That's used in 25 states in 616 jurisdictions right now. What we also found and have now ascertained for sure is that the thing that he found has migrated to the other vendors. So Hart InterCivic incorporated it in 2006. It's now in Dominion, and according to a letter from a lawyer from the Illinois Board of Elections, and also in ESNF. What it does is it fractionalizes the counting of the vote, which is disturbing in and of itself. But what I came to understand in making the video is it's not the fractions in the votes that are even the worst part of it. What fractions do is they can enable you to preset a result by percentage. And that enables a great deal of percentage in terms of absolute control of precinct results and results in any jurisdiction. So in other words, just think of it like if you say, I'm going to give this guy 43% of the vote, and you have 100 votes come in, you have no idea how many voters are going to show up, but you have 100 votes come in, and you're going to give 43%. You're going to be capped at that. You're not going to let it get any more than that. Well, that's 43 votes. That's a whole number. Fine. But if 99 votes come in, all of a sudden they're going to produce decimals on that vote because it won't divide. You can get 43% of 99 votes and have a vote total without decimals. By incorporating decimals into the count, it enables setting of caps and precise preset percentages, and that enables an incredibly powerful method of controlling election results. So that's what the video is going to show.
All right, Bev Harris, anyone with any questions for Bev? Amy Cannon.
Hi, Bev.
Hi.
Since I've worked with you on this for a couple of months now, I want to just ask this question publicly. Because the understanding people have had of the worry that elections can have preset results has been framed as an outside attacker intruding into the results as announced. But I'm just asking you to confirm that what the existence of fractionalization, essentially accounting software that meant $1 is 100 cents and one voter can be 100 one-hundredths of a vote, changed to 43 one-hundredths of a vote, and somebody else into 150 one-hundredths of a vote, and the difference going somewhere else. It means that, as I call it, your crazy, kind uncle who, you know, knows somebody in the jurisdiction that needed to save their house or whatever and needed some money. That is the level at which these percentages can be set. We don't need an intruder from Russia or anywhere else. Is that true?
Right. This is not about the Russians are coming. This is about something that was put in there, and basically anyone with inside access could access it. And it's been in the system, in the Evil Gem system, it's been in there for 15 years, and it's been in the other vendors for 10 years now. And we think that it was put in there to enable basically local contract fraud. You know, there's one presidential election every 4 years. You're not going to make much money if you're selling elections if you're doing that. There are 100,000 local elections every year, and they control hundreds of billions of dollars in contract fees and payroll. That's where the gravy train is. And that's where you get local yokels wanting to put their thumb on the scale so their guy gets the contract. And we believe that's actually why this originated, was to be able to enable local and regional tampering by insiders who basically have the magic key. Now, if you think about it, the meaning of a good ground game can also mean you know how to access those local fixtures.
Okay, let's see, another question.
Thank you. This is Judy Beth, EDA. Beth, congratulations on your
work. Hi.
My question is for the uninitiated. I understood what we were saying, but I'm not sure everybody would. And let's just check my understanding. Are we not saying that, like, if I have a nefarious registrar of voters, that registrar of voters can actually use the fraction magic to alter the results of an election?
Well, when the registrar, it was one of the, yes, if they could, if they're experienced. But what I found is typically the registrars and the election administrators actually have no idea how their own system works. They turn it over to often outside jobbers, contract jobbers. Sometimes it's the large jurisdictions, the inside IT guys. But it is, there is a whole network of people who have inside access. It's really quite stunning now. They probably at least 5,000 nationwide, and some of them have very broad reach. For example, there's one company called SOE Software that can basically make direct access into the tabulators in 1,000 jurisdictions, including several whole states. They've got the entire state, which is North Carolina, entire state of Georgia, and both of those are swing states. So, you know, you've got, yes, it's talking about a nefarious person can do it, but our findings are that it's probably not the local election official because they're rather clueless about how their system works.
Yeah, good point, Bev. I visited SOE. They asked me to leave. They said they don't really do software. They only do custom work. And it's one-stop shopping. Not only will they register your voters, control your database, run your central tabulators, they will also do your social media and election night reporting. So a very interesting company that was bought up by CEIC when CEIC came under attack for being a foreign company out of Barcelona, Spain.
Yeah, and this is really, by the way, they also have their own little cloud server so that this is a nice thing. Election officials can put everything they have on SOE software server. Instead of having to have the inconvenience of having it on the county server, which gives them total control over everything and a first look at everything. It really ranges from, you know, the big vendors, the SNS, which in their contract requires that they can have remote desktop access to systems, to SOE, which has, these other services, too, some very small contract jobbers. For example, John Elder, who's kind of got notoriety back with Jeffrey D in those days, former narcotics trafficker, he still does provide election programming services. He's a convicted felon, and so it's sort of dodgy how he does it. He has a website for an entity called Showcase Management, which pretends it's a record-producing company. But when you delve into it, the only service they provide is programming elections.
Hi, Beth. This is Barbara Simons.
Hi, Barbara.
Hi, Beth. I agree with you that there can be issues with paperless machines or places where there aren't audits, but would you agree that if there are paper ballots with proper post-election ballot audits, this kind of issue could be dealt with?
Hello?
How it would work?
Probably not. One of the things that we found, let me just mention two things. Poll tapes. A lot of people also say, well, there's poll tapes, the machines make tapes. At this point in time, 80% of the votes in America do not have a poll tape. No vote by mail, no early voting, no central count, no combined vote centers. They've started to ditch the poll tapes for those. So that leaves us with audits. What we're finding with the audits, if they're done, is they omit whole segments of the vote. For example, the state of California has given authorization to all of its counties to omit large sections of the absentee vote entirely from the audit. Some states completely omit the vote by mail, even if the vote by mail is in somebody's place of 80% of the vote. But the other thing is, like, you have places that do what I would call a sham audit. Cuyahoga County did a spot check where a couple people went to jail in 2004. Well, what they did was they said our random is our random, and they actually pre-selected the precinct ahead of time. Fresno County did that this year. They pre-selected their precinct for the audit 2 months ahead of time. Who knew? You only know if you check. And if you pre-select the precinct, fraction magic, the way it works, is very precise, and you can simply omit those precincts from the fraction magic, and they will always stand up to an audit. So the assumption, one of the differences, I think, between academia and those of us who are actually out in the field is the assumptions of academia on what if something's in an operations manual that is done, it is not in the problem location.
I just wanted to push back a little bit on that. I agree with you that mail-in ballots should be included in audits, and I think
Actually, the Secretary of State was mistaken in California when he issued that statement. And in fact, Philip Stark, who is the person who invented risk limiting audit, is testifying against what the Secretary of State said. So I'm not sure what you mean by academics, but Philip, of course, is an academic, and he is on the same side of this issue as you are. I would just respect, you know, I would just suggest that if post-election ballot audits are properly done, then this risk that they will not be properly done.
They will not be properly done in corrupt locations.
Well, if you've got corruption.
They will not be properly done. How do you know if it's properly done?
Because you have transparency.
This is the difference, and I'm going to push that very hard on this. I've been in the field, but in the video, you will see some clips of what really happens when you try to do this.
Okay, wrapping up, I want to get Paul Thomas in. Yes. One last quick question.
Yeah, yeah.
Hi, Bev. This is Paul Thomas. The question is, do you have any indication anywhere in Easter eggs in the code or written hints somewhere in the margin that instruct people on how to do this, or would you think this comes strictly from training the consultants who go in and handle the contract?
I think it's probably less, because if you look at who put it into the system, these are contract jobbers like Jeffrey Dean. So if I go back to Jeffrey Dean, who was a computer project guy, the guy who put it into the system originally, and proved after the court records and the code. In terms of can it be figured out, though, by some local, I think it can be figured out. And that's when you get some of these very oddball results, because if you don't do it right, if you don't do it really, you know, in a really slick way, you will leave telltale signs. For example, in Memphis, Tennessee, in the 2014 election, they had a whole string of one-off errors, meaning round-off errors. They were all in the judicial races. And it would be the equivalent of 2 plus 2 equals 5. And when that happens, it might be like 2.5 is rounded up to 3, you know, and so you end up getting roundup there. So that's done most likely when you have somebody local doing it who hasn't really got the correct master key to it. It's very, very precise when you have the right key.
All right, Bev Harris, the founding mother of the movement, the woman who revealed faith-based voting and pushed the prayer. Bev, thank you very, very much.
Okay, thanks, and have a good time there, what you're doing. And, look for it. I'll have the announcement. It may be the middle of the night, but it'll be up tonight.
Thank you, Beth. And now I'd like Dr. Shaw of Grace Lutheran Church to come forward.
Well, welcome. And in fact, while they're getting the last IT items set up, I want to introduce one of the founding co-pastors, the senior pastor, the person that makes all of this happen, is a longtime professor at the Pacific Lutheran Theological Seminary, one of the founders of this church from 60 years ago, and his mission and his decision was that he wanted to keep a Lutheran presence in the community, and he realized that there were changes, such as the changes that are happening right now, that were in the midst, and he was willing to hang in there and continue to see the community grow and expand, and events like what you're having now. And so I also want to introduce our senior pastor of Grace Lutheran Church. This is Pastor Walter Stewart.
This place
40 years ago. I wouldn't have been room for you here on Sunday morning. Full of children and grown-ups. The congregation has declined over the years. We have a decision whether we continue here or not. We decided we should continue a certain presence in Richmond. And so we had to think about what kind of ministry we'd have. So we have a ministry of worship here on Sunday morning. There are three different congregations worshiping here. The ministry of food distribution during the week. There's a food pantry, gives food out twice a week. We have a music ministry where children come here for instruction. Dr. Shaw is the leader. And we see this as kind of ministry also we have where we make the church premises available for groups that need space. So you see what you're doing here as part of our ministry. You're welcome here this morning. We're glad to have you here.
Stand for this. If you're able, if you feel like standing, wave your hand or whatever you want. Yeah, feel free. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome.
Force. So here's the message.
Start a NAACP
Restart.
Yeah, it's coming up. All right, here we go.
My name is Hillary Shelton, Director of the NAACP's Washington Bureau. The Washington Bureau is the federal legislative and national public policy arm of the nation's oldest and largest civil rights organization, the NAACP. I am so deeply honored that you've given me this opportunity to speak to you as you move and work together in your conference to take back the vote. I cannot begin to tell you just how extremely important it is that this year, all years, the group organized just the way that you're doing. You see, this is the first year in the last 50 years plus that we are going into a federal election, an election period, without the full protections of the Voting Rights Act of 1965. And you may know that in the Supreme Court decision of Shelton versus Soper, the Supreme Court decided by a 5-4 decision that they would strike down one of the most important provisions in the Voting Rights Act to prevent discrimination. As you know, if we don't stop it at the front end, no one gets a chance to vote, or doesn't. It'll be those who decide what comes out of the back end, who we elect. And this year is crucial. This year we're electing a president and a vice president. We're electing 33 senators and 435 members of the House of Representatives, including 5 delegates. We're electing governors and members of state legislatures and members of city councils, mayors, and others all over the country. This year is crucial. But this year we also know, as we look at the presidential election, there's so much disparity in those that are running. So all voices need to be heard. As we say, all hands need to be on deck. So moving through this process, we know that not only do we have to prepare to first help register voters, educate them on the issues, and get them out to vote on election day, but we also have to make sure that we are protecting the vote all the way around what we call our election protection process. It is our hope that as you're making your plans today and the days that are a part of this conference, that we're thinking about what has to happen for us to coordinate to make sure that we're serving as monitors at polling sites, that we're watching what's going on, and that we know when we see shenanigans happen, disenfranchising processes occurring, that we're contacting the right people. That's why the NAACP, working with our coalition partners, has set up a voting hotline. That phone number, and I hope you'll write this down, is 1-866-OUR-VOTE. 1-866-OUR-VOTE. This is connected to the NAACP, our friends at the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law, the Advancement Project, the ACLU, and many other organizations that will be working on Election Day to help protect that vote. If you see a problem, you call. We will coordinate with our lawyers on the ground, wherever you might be, to send them out to see if we need to file a lawsuit, an injunction, or how we need to address the problem. But we must move quickly in each of these circumstances to actually protect that vote, to provide that opportunity. We also want to make sure we recognize that once the election day is over, our job really just begins. We put the right people in place and perhaps even pass the right referendum. But as we move into a moving agenda, it's so important to all of us to address our real concerns and our values that we're prepared there as well. The NAACP maintains something called our Broadcast Email Action Alert Network. This is a tool that we utilize to educate our people on the issues, engage them in the process, give them the talking point they need to talk to members of the legislature, our other government affairs leaders, collect that information, and prepare to address those issues as well. If you'd like to get information and sign up for that network, you can do one of a couple of things. You can either go to the NAACP's website at naacp.org. naacp.org will take you to our website. Or you can send us an email that would include your name, your address, including your zip code. We use that to determine who your member of the House of Representatives is, and your email address, so that whenever bills are being introduced, whenever they're moving, when the hearings are being held, when the final vote happens on the floor of the House or the Senate, we send your information out so you have the talking points, the sample letters, the background information on these initiatives so you can be actively involved in the board, remember the House or the Senate, accountable for the outcome of that particular piece of legislation. So it's a crucial time for us, a crucial time for all of us. The stakes have never been higher. There are those who want to build walls between us and other civilizations. There are those who believe that racial profiling through stop and frisk is a good idea. There are those who hold many other positions that are going to be coming up, and it's up to us to decide who should sit in these important positions of power. So ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, it's time for us to think about how we're going to be able to move initiatives and fix the Voting Rights Act. How are we going to be able to address issues and concerns around how police officers handle business in our communities? How often they pull out their guns and shoot unarmed people? How they address issues of racial profiles and other concerns? Whether they should wear body cameras and whether we should keep data off whenever they shoot and kill American citizens. We want to make sure we're very able to address issues like our health care system. We work very hard to implement this initiative that added 25 million more Americans to the health care rolls. And I can tell you that since we've done that, this has changed some of the political arena that occurred on Capitol Hill. The U.S. House of Representatives moved over 50 times to repeal that crucial piece of legislation just to make sure that every American can have health care as we move through their society. What good is freedom if you don't have your health? We want to make sure we move ahead to make sure issues of education are very front and center on the table as well. It is more expensive now than ever to go to colleges and universities, but the resources that we need for things like Pell Grants and other forms of student aid, not to mention student loans, are affordable and accessible and manageable for all of us. There's so many other issues we have to take into consideration, including the creation of jobs or the opportunity to start small businesses. All those issues are on the table, and it is up to us to make sure we're able to move our vote forward, to vote our beliefs, our feelings, our aspirations, and make sure that those who are put in power do what we ask them to do. So brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, let me stop there and say thank you. Thank you again for what you're doing during this meeting, and thank you for the new opportunities that we will have to work together to build a coalition, to find that convergence, and make sure that America lives up to its constitutional promises of equal opportunity for all. Thanks again, and I look forward to working.
All right. Just a quick side note, I was on that panel with Hillary Shelton. I addressed the D.C. and Virginia bar after testifying before Congress, talking about it a little later on. So with that in mind, we're going back to John Brakey. Those of you who were here yesterday know that he's concerned with audits in Arizona. John, welcome.
Thank you, Bob. It's a real pleasure to be here. My name is John Roberts Brakey. I'm with a group called Audit AZ, which is an acronym for Americans United for Democracy, Integrity, and Transparency. I've been involved with elections since this group, and I want to let you know that I'm a formerly election integrity activist, but now I've changed. I am a transparency activist in elections. So ET rather than EI. And once you get the message that, you know, that me and other people who are becoming very aware that there is a very strong possibility that we can make elections that are transparent, you know, taking the black box, making it into a transparent box, elections that are trackable, chain of custody, you know, using ballot imagery, which could be used to go ahead and make elections where you could be at home and make it publicly verifiable. Now, the thing I find very interesting in the work the last few months that I've been doing with Bev Harris and many other people in this country is that 40% of the voting machines in this country now have what they call ballot images. Now, the sad thing about it is nobody really knows about it. Before I go more into that, I kind of want to give you the history of where ballot images and how this process kind of started or whatever, is that when Bev Harris hooked up with Harry Hursty and brought him in, they had a sit down and they talked about what could be a way to make elections verifiable. And that message got out, and then eventually Lori Grace, thank you Lori, Mitch Trachtenberg, they kind of built the first system. And that's what they call Humboldt County, and they built it as like a tandem system. At that point, a man who developed Lotus Notes, Larry Moore, said, gee, I like what they're doing, and, you know, why can't we build a system? And, of course, it would be nice to see it open source, but, you know, if we can't get open source, how about open source ballots? How about that you can see, if go ahead, have these ballot images put online by precinct, and you could download them. And in Wisconsin, there's a group there that have developed a little tiny program. And they take the images per precinct, and what they do is that they put them in little packs of 25. They have four people involved. They have little clickers. And let's say that you two are going to go ahead and verify Joe Schmo's election, and you two got beat Storkish. They'll use a TV screen, flat screen big, and every second and a half, a new image will pop up and you hear a beep. And if you two are counting for Joe Schmo, you put a click. If you guys are talking for Pete Pastorkish, you click when you see his name. You stop at 25, you look at each other and say, what did you count? Oh, 10, good, it matches. Let's do the next 25. Then you get a precinct done, and then you look at the result and you see if it matches. Now, of course, it is imagery. You know, you don't want to rely 100% on it, okay? Because the real goals is undoubtedly Barbara Simon or our friends back there would say, is that the real important thing is the original ballot. And this is where I'm very impressed with the work of Dr. Phil Stark and his risk-limited audits. If you're examining a race that's a 70-30, you may have to pull 8 or 10 ballots and go in and say, hey, we checked it, everything adds up. Now, could you please help me verify? Because I want to explain to you the process on the new ES&S machine called the 850 and also the ES&S DS Series 200. When a ballot goes through the machine, it takes a picture of it. The minute the picture is successful, the image, it then instantly puts a number on the corner of the ballot, a serialized number. It then encrypts that number onto the image. And then it registers at the end of election in a cast vote record. I have one. Our last election, we had 176,478 people vote. The cast vote record is a tremendous tool. It has 176,478 column lines. And these column lines can be used because, you know, in a large jurisdiction or a county, you could have, in a primary, 1,200 ballot styles. And when you look at that row, it just goes on and on and on because every ballot could be a little different. You got ballot rotation, but it's all there. You can go ahead, also use that to go ahead and check the election results. And then once again, it's important to go back to the original ballot to verify. Now the bad news, I cannot find any county in the country thus far that's not destroying. In fact, when they developed the system, they only developed it because of competition. It came about because, like I said, Lori, working with Mitch, getting this thing built, Larry Moore came in, hey, this is a great system. I'm going to go ahead and develop it. ES&S says, hey, I'm already there. We're 61% of the country. They developed it. They developed it several years ago. And their original advertising bragged about having the ballot imagery. We found that. Susan Pinchoff found it in Russ Michaels in the Virgin Islands. We couldn't find any manuals. We went ahead and filed a lawsuit. We forced Pima County and ES&S, by the way. ES&S, we didn't have to force them. Pima County said, hey, don't give them to Brady. Don't give them to NAACP. We got a lawyer for you. Claim priority. You know, don't do it. While Pima County was destroying their ballot images on a daily basis. Incredible. 11 of my counties of the 15 in the state of Arizona have these images. Bob Fitrakis checked with Cuyahoga County, the largest county in Ohio, and they said, gee, we never turned it on. Well, that's a lie, because you can't do a count unless you turn it on, and you cannot count unless the image has been done. The megasite, that image was made, it's a public record, okay? Under the Help America Vote Act, they say the envelopes, because, you know, I do a lot of audits. I'm a front linesman. I'm, you know, in the last 12 years, I've probably been involved into 12 lawsuits, and that's why I'm so glad to meet my favorite scientist back there. And I deeply thank you, because, you know, you cannot believe how many of your conspiracy factualist papers I use. And because, you know, you are the number one conspiracy factualist, and that's a really big compliment. And well, he's the number one. He taught us, and I'm grateful to Deborah Bowen, because, you know, she really graduated. And, you know, that's such an important part. Now, knowing this, what do we do? I'm for solutions. I'm tired of talking about the problems. I want to demand that elections are transparent, get rid of the black box, that are trackable in a CDR that is put out there for us, and that they're publicly verifiable, that I can invite some friends over to my house, take my computer, plug it into my flat screen with my four little clickers, and just click away verifying elections. Because I know that elections are stolen with impunity. Okay? And you know, there's 50 states in this country, and there's 50 systems. And our elections are procedurally based, as Barbara Simon was talking about this morning. I am in total agreement with you, Barbara. We need evidentiary type elections. Proof. And that's where the future really is. But really the future to me is to get our Civil Rights Act back, as the NCAA talked about, and we need to go ahead and make precincts again. We need community, we need small precincts, we need young people coming in and working these things with older people, and building community, and make Elections Day a holiday that everybody has to write. Because I want to tell you about my favorite election. My favorite election was just before I had my heart attack. I was with Jim Arch, and we did the Indian Reservation in St. Charles Apache Tribe. It was wonderful. I was so particularly happy to see we were monitoring three precincts. They were using electronic voting. They're using M100s by ESNS, a very old system. And 75 feet around, it was a holiday for them to vote. And, you know, the candidates were there. Gee, can I get a cup of coffee? Can you have a, you know, a taquito or whatever? And then, you know, and everybody's talking. It was a festive event. And then I saw a bus pull up. And these guys with orange jumpsuits jumped out. And they were marched into the precinct. They were the prisoners. What they were saying is, you're still part of us. You made a mistake, like I made a mistake when I was younger. You know, the first place I ever voted, I'm not ashamed to say this, I voted in prison. I was 18 years old. I was in for drug charges, okay? I made a mistake. I got my redemption. I was a psychotherapist for 5 years after that. You know, fortunately, I'm ADD. I think that's good. Makes me a great investigator. I'm not a public speaker. And I apologize for my grammar. I'm not super educated or anything, but I'm very intuitive, and I am a bulldog, and my tenacity is incredible. I work elections. I teach the seven C's to my friends. Character, capacity, credibility, civility. Oh, that's a big part of the game. Proud of my citizenship. Sometimes I worry about my country, where it's going. But you know, the seventh C that is the most important is courage. Courage to stand up and say, this is wrong, and do it with civility, and think before what you say, because what kind of a character has the capacity to say a bunch of bull and destroys credibility? Because that's all I got to sell, is my credibility. And I know that if we work hard, we can all make sure that we focus in on these swing states. I want you to know the state of Maine has gone completely with the DS series. The state of Maryland is 100%. Arizona is 40% with these new engines. I'm sorry to say California has very little. We've got some of the oldest equipment around. There may be a little bit dabbled around the state, but I'm not finding very much. I'm hoping that the new system, Mimi, that you're working on, bless you. I love you for what you do. And I just see you as probably the number one light worker in the movement. And thank you so much. Because me working with you all these years has meant a lot to me. It really has. So, just to wrap this thing up, you know, I know that John F. Kennedy was right, that one person can make a difference. And we all really need to try. I know that I'm making a difference. And I'm so proud to see a lot of young people here who are starting to get involved and see these things. Thank you, Summer Rose, for everything that you do. Every time I sit around, I see a video of you hammering away. And I know that we're going to be hammering on this. That really pleases me tremendously. Because we've got to reach out to these states. We need to reach out to Shelton, the NAACP, and see what help he can get. Because there is a technique that I'm developing right now, we're doing right now. One, what can we do? You file a records request, very simple. And you say to them, hi, according to the state of Arizona, your state of course, here is my records request per law, da-da-da-da. I am requesting the ballot images from the last election. And I also am making a demand to get the ones for the November 7th election. And they're going to turn on and say, oh, we haven't got any. We didn't turn the switch on. Well, that's a lie. Well, they're going to say, we have the original ballots. And we can't give those to you, but, maybe you can get with a judge and we'll give you permission to go look at it. Well, they're not going to give you permission to look at the originals because they're the original. And they're going to give you an excuse. They're going to say, if you get those originals, how do you know you haven't got a piece of lead below your finger? You don't want it marked on the ballot, so can't have them. Well, those ballot images are a public record. Once they tell you you can't have them, then you file a special action called a temporary restraining order. And then you go ahead, and you want to keep it simple. You don't want to make the case convoluted because you can't get it until they're there. Okay, so that's number two. That's where we're in the process right now. We've already got our restraining order. The ballot images for the August 30 of the election in Arizona have been preserved in Pima County. And now we're back in court the 14th to make it. Well, you're going to have to stay in for federal law for 22 months. Okay, well, then I file suit number three. The number three suit is, give me the ballot images. Now we're going to fight about that. It's important in litigation, if you're going to work going up against the status quo, you film the court case. I film everything, okay? It's important that you keep your lawsuit simple. The other side's going to try to distract you. They're going to say, gee, Your Honor, if they get these ballot images, they can turn around and people can have a secret mark on them and they'll sell their vote. You know what I call that? Vote by mail. Okay? So that wipes out that argument right there. We can do this and make an effect. We can go ahead and make sure that these ballot images are really the future, because really the future is getting the hardware that's off the shelf. The technology has really advanced. And because right now, these older machines, when they read your vote, they're using a marked sensitive type reading. And there's no image, you just pick up that there's a light spot difference on the ballot because you darkened it in. And that's how the process kind of works. So going this route is very important. Just let you know, I'm the guy who sued the whole state of Arizona earlier this year. To watch what happened, my state was sham. And I want to quickly tell you what happened. Hillary Clinton wins the vote by mail by 60%. Bernie Sanders wins the precinct vote by 60%. And the provisionals come in 63. That's a 40% difference. 150,000 people in Maricopa were disenfranchised, easily proven. The rest of the state is up 9% in voting, and they're down 4. Well, anybody can do the math. Other than that, I thank you for your time, and I look forward to talking to anybody about this subject as we can get there. Thank you.
John Brickey, my good friend, out of Arizona. Okay, we've got a little video message here before we go on to our next speaker. So is the message ready?
Yes.
All right.
Projector.
Okay, as we wait for you to come out, Alex, it's here. Are legal fiction. I hear you don't believe they have the same rights as flesh and blood people. But I put that aside. And I'm wondering about Derek Pressman. Number one, he's a longtime democracy advocate and will be speaking on that key decision, Citizens United and campaign financing in California, and that dark money that Jane Mayer talks about in her book. So I give you Derek Pressman.
All right, thank you, Bob. It is great to be here. We're testing our mouse, which might make...
No.
I'm giving it back. I realize that the main topic that we're all here to talk
talk about today is election integrity and making sure that, that ballots are counted as cast and that the entire elections process from registration to casting to counting to auditing ballots reflects the true intent of the voter and in fact is capturing public opinion and the will and consent of the governed, which is what our government is supposed to be based upon. I want to step back even further a bit from that and talk about making sure that the integrity of the system in which we form public opinion and indeed form our own opinions is sound. Because I believe it is at that very fundamental level that we have been threatened not only by the Citizens United ruling but by Supreme Court rulings going back 40 years, starting with a ruling called Buckley versus Vallejo. So, we just heard about some litigation, right, and the importance of litigation. Imagine if you were in a court of law and you had the judge tell your side, okay, you've got 1 minute to make your closing arguments, but now we're going to hear 9 minutes from the other side. And even on the front end of that process, they'd say, okay, we're going to have briefs turned in, and your side can turn in a 5-page brief, and the other side is going to turn in a 45-page brief. No one would think for a minute that that process was fair, but just as importantly, if you were that judge, could you honestly say to yourself that you are making a wise decision based on such lopsided information that you were receiving as an impartial person? Well, I don't think so, and that's why the United States Supreme Court puts very strict limits on the amount of pages and briefs that get submitted to it so that each side gets an equal voice. And they, when they have oral arguments, they put very strict limits on the amount of time that each side can argue in front of the United States Supreme Court. We do the same thing on the floor of Congress and in our state legislatures when we're time they have left, and you know, I yield 3 minutes to the gentleman from Virginia and so on and so forth, because we have accepted as a society that for our public policy decisions to have integrity, we need to hear from all sides equally. So I put out a book on this topic about, not quite a year ago, January, called When Money Talks, and I was thinking about it as I was driving here, because practically just across the street is the Richmond City Hall. And I opened the book with a scene from the Richmond City Hall that illustrates this principle of we limit how much any one person can talk so that everybody has a chance to hear. And I was in the Richmond City Hall at a city council meeting one day, and there was a gentleman who had a lot to say. And the mayor had a real challenge getting him to adhere to his time limits. And eventually the police, years ago, and the Supreme Court said, the concept that we may limit the speech of one person in order to enhance the relative voice of others is wholly foreign to the First Amendment. You would think these people had never read the First Amendment, because it does not say anything about there. And in all of these other forms, that's precisely what we do. And yet, in that ruling, they struck down limits that had been passed by Congress in the wake of Watergate that put a mandatory limit, an equal limit, on the amount that each candidate would spend in a political campaign. And in fact, that ruling was used to strike down a law passed by the voters of California, the Political Reform Act, originally authored by Secretary of State Jerry Brown, ballot measure 9 in 1974, that also set mandatory limits on the amount that each candidate would spend in a political campaign, so that voters, acting in essence as judges and decision makers, could hear equal information from all sides. So the problem goes way back to there, and then Citizens United made it worse with this idea of artificial integrity, and say, not only are we going to let a billionaire candidate self-finance their own campaign with no limits, or a candidate that can raise lots of money from wealthy interests spent with no limits, we're actually going to allow the CEO of a corporation to use other people's money, their shareholders' money, their customers' money, without, forget their consent, without even their knowledge, on a political purpose that was not the reason they gave you that money, right? They gave you that money because they were buying a tank of gas at Chevron, not because they wanted to support a particular candidate that the CEO of Chevron wants to support. So that completely undermines the integrity of our decision-making process when you can literally have somebody speaking on someone else's behalf with their money without their knowledge or consent
And the thing that I think is really perhaps reaching us to a tipping point on this issue is, as President Obama correctly pointed out in the State of the Union address, once you are saying that corporations are people and that we are not going to limit the amount that they can speak, you are opening a back door for foreign interests to influence our elections through investing in U.S. firms and subsidiaries. And actually, there's a great investigative reporter just across the bay there, Lee Fang. I don't know if he's read his piece in The Intercept, where he actually documented that this happened in our presidential primary. There was a Chinese national who owns a multinational firm that has a subsidiary in the United States that put $1 million into the Republican presidential primary. So this is not some hypothetical thing, Justice Alito, that somebody just made up. It is real, it is happening, and it is a result of this crazy idea that corporations are people and they have the same constitutional rights that living, breathing people like you and I do. So we are living in this upside-down world where money is free speech, where corporations are people, that we are not allowed to create a system of integrity in our public policy and public discourse process because of the Supreme Court. How do we fix this as citizens? And while there are a lot of ways to do this, and a lot of people right now are basing their votes for U.S. president based upon who might appoint a new justice to the Supreme Court, and I think that's a legitimate consideration to take into account when you're voting for president, I ultimately believe that the most permanent solution and the most sweeping solution to this would be to reverse the United States Supreme Court by passing a constitutional amendment. Just as we reversed Supreme Court rulings that denied women the right to vote with a constitutional amendment, just as we have reversed, seven of our 27 constitutional amendments have reversed misguided Supreme Court rulings in the past. So this is a difficult thing to do. And I have been thinking about this topic and working on this topic since about 1995, and back in the 90s, I started doing research. It's like, well, how have citizens passed constitutional amendments, particularly ones that go directly against the self-interest of incumbents, as this issue does? Because everybody gets to Congress by playing under the current set of rules, so they're not very eager to change that. Well, it turns out we have done that before, and we have done tougher things than this before. And one of the best examples is when we gave ourselves the right to vote for U.S. Senator. At our founding, senators were appointed by state legislatures, and this process became unbelievably corrupt, where corporate CEOs and billionaires were literally bribing state legislators to get themselves appointed to the United States Senate. And as you can imagine, they were not really wild about the idea of changing that process where they'd actually have to face voters. So you had constitutional amendments passing the House of Representatives for decades, calling for direct election of senators, getting crushed in the United States Senate. And one of the key things that started turning that tide was in 1891, the California legislature exercised a provision for voter instructions in our state constitution and put a question on our ballot saying, would you like to be able to vote directly for U.S. senators? Lo and behold, 90% of Californians say, yeah, we think that would be great. And this sparked a movement that then went to other states, including Oregon and others, where voters were directly weighing in through this process called voter instructions. And that history is what we are trying to revive with Proposition 59, which is a voter instruction on our ballot this November. See if we can actually read it. There we go.
There.
So this is the text of Proposition 59, and it is a chance for California voters in every single congressional district in the state of California to give pretty explicit instructions to their member of Congress about how they would like to represent them. Because that, after all, is the job of a United States representative, right? Is we send someone from our community to go to Washington, D.C., since we can't go there ourselves, and ask them to represent our views. Now, there are, by 82%, overwhelming margins, and if you look at polling from across the country, they are transpartisan margins. Republicans, Democrats, Independents, Greens,
all think we need to overturn the Citizens United ruling and think that a constitutional amendment is an appropriate way to do that. So that's one objective. The second objective is to make sure we actually win in every single congressional district, because that really is the point here, is each voter is instructing their individual member of Congress. And we have some pretty important members of Congress in California, the largest congressional delegation in the country, including Nancy Pelosi from San Francisco and Kevin McCarthy from Bakersfield. I would like to see us win resounding margins in both of those congressional districts. And then this is just the first step in the process. The next thing that we need to do is hold members of Congress accountable to this vote after it happens. And that's where, in some ways, part of the efforts that are going on right now, and I see someone with a Yes on 59 t-shirt, which is great. You know, we want to build a volunteer infrastructure that exists in every single congressional district to follow up on this work later. This is a status of where we are now, and I think this is important to realize when you hear skeptics going, oh, we'll never pass a constitutional amendment. Well, first, we've done it 27 times in circumstances tougher than this. But secondly, we have made a lot of progress here in the state of California, where we are close to having two-thirds of our congressional delegation already co-sponsoring one or more federal constitutional amendments to deal with this problem. So this map here gives you a sense of it. All those green areas right there represent where we have a current member of Congress that is already on board with this idea and has co-sponsored and would be in compliance with the instructions of Prop 59. Those blue areas are areas represented by a Democrat who has not yet taken action, and the red areas are areas that are represented by a Republican who has not yet taken action on this. California has an opportunity to lead the country by picking up bipartisan support for this issue through the strength of constituent instructions. And to that end, it's very important to think about how we talk about this issue. You may notice this in the press, that there are people who are not very wild about this idea of overturning Citizens United who are trying to downplay the importance of this and saying, well, it's only advisory. And that is true in that we don't have an opportunity to take a member of Congress to court if they and legally enforce this or immediately impeach them or something like that if they don't follow these instructions. But just as when your employer tells you to do something, they can't take you to court to force you to do it, but they can fire you if you don't. And that is the same opportunity that California voters will have, is to fire members of Congress who disregard our instructions on this issue.
And the Supreme Court.
Yeah. Well, and then there's the Supreme Court, which is a whole other can of worms that tried to keep this off the ballot and tried to prevent us from even having a voice to speak out on this issue in the first place. And whole long, crazy story about that I'm happy to talk more about during a question and answer. But so that's what Prop 59 is about. There's a similar question on the ballots in Washington State this year. This is part of a national movement that really is sweeping the country and I think can be a tool to hold members of Congress accountable and ultimately provide a way for we the people to serve as a check and balance against the Supreme Court that I think has gone off the rails and exceeded their authority in telling us how we can run our elections and who counts as a person under the Constitution written by we the people. So that's Prop 59. Let me talk real briefly about some of the other good things that have been happening in California and some things that still need to be done. But we had a victory just a week or two ago where Governor Jerry Brown signed a bill, SB 1107, that basically legalizes what's called citizen-funded elections for local communities all across the state of California. We've already had programs of public financing of campaigns in some of our larger charter cities like Los Angeles, San Francisco, Long Beach, but if you weren't a charter city, you didn't have the ability to adopt that. Berkeley is a charter city, and actually we'll have a question on its ballot in a month. It's called X1, to create a system of matching funds so that candidates who run their campaigns based upon small donations will receive extra public funds that they can use to compete with the super PAC candidates that are not running on small contributions. So it's a way to help ensure that everybody's voice gets heard and voters can then make informed, balanced decisions. There was a bill that was pushed through by Senator Bob Hertzberg to improve our CalExcess program, where the Secretary of State's office runs the, and if any of you ever tried to use this, you probably know what I'm talking about. It's a very clunky sort of 1990s era software program where you can try to find out who is funding campaigns in California if you're really good at downloading and combining a bunch of Excel files and sorting them out. There's now funding available and a mandate for that process to be upgraded, so that's some progress. I'd love to see it go even further, where some of that data gets grabbed out and put into the voter's guide, the digital voter's guide. So still more to be done, but good progress happening. And then one piece that did not happen but came very close was the California Disclosed Act, led by the California Clean Money Campaign, to pull some of that donor information and actually put it in the bottoms of the ads so that you can see who are the real funders behind a campaign. You know, not Californians for Motherhood and Apple Pie, but Californians for Motherhood and Apple Pie, funded by Chevron and Philip Morris. Tells you a lot more about who those Californian people really are. So that's a quick synopsis of where things are here in California, as well as part of this national movement dealing with a runaway Supreme Court. I'm getting told I need to limit my speech so that other people may be heard, which is a concept that I strongly believe in. So let me wrap it up at that. And are we doing questions now or later? Or somebody later. Great. Well, thank you all for coming, seriously.
Okay, let's see. The break has been canceled. It's very sad because there's all sorts of legal fictions and unnatural people outside waiting to meet here with some dark money. All right, next up, Kevin Collins of the Humboldt Transparency Project will discuss the pioneering work in that area.
Good afternoon. I've been asked to give a brief history, a description of what we do, what we've done, and where we are. The Election Transparency Project in Humboldt can trace its roots back to spring of 2003. That's when our election manager, Lindsay McWilliams, announced that he wanted to switch the county from a paper-based ballot that was marked by the voter and optically scanned to all electronic paperless touchscreens. I'd read an article in Salon.com called Voting in the Void about 6 months before that, describing what had happened in Florida in their primary in 2002 when Janet Reno was running for governor on the Democratic primary. And probably lost that bid because 300,000 votes went missing and they were not recoverable because they were paperless touchscreens. So I thought it was a bad idea. I tried to persuade Lindsay that it was a bad idea, but he wouldn't be convinced. So a like-minded friend and myself went to our supervisors thinking we'd have to override the manager's decision and stop it at the supervisor's level. They were interested, they listened, and then told us that really we should be talking to the county clerk, Carolyn Cernich. It turns out that an administration shuffle had incorporated the elections office into the clerk's office, and that she was now the registrar of voters. So we went to her office that same day, and we were lucky she was in. And she received us warmly, and more so when we told her why we were there, because all she had heard was Lindsay's arguments about how great these machines were going to be. We had a good discussion. She asked questions. We left a packet of materials, including literature for verified voting, black box voting, MIT study, Dr. Rebecca Mercury from Harvard, all saying that paperless voting was a bad idea. So before we left, she said that she'd been on the fence about going to a conference to discuss this very subject. And now she had decided she'd probably go to that conference, which was a couple months away. So we left. We felt we had a good day, and we had a better day several months later when Carolyn came back from that conference and took Lindsay's proposal, paperless voting, and put it on the shelf. So, yeah, I thought that was pretty good. But, of course, as Dr. Simons was telling you, that's when California is a model state with a 1% audit, but that still meant that there was 99% that wasn't being audited. And we knew that, but then we were soon to see Harry Hursky and Bev Harris in Florida hacking into the very deep old GEMS tabulators that we had in the county and reversing the voters' intent in about 10 minutes. And then we also found out that the fellow who wrote the software for our county on the central county vote by mail, had about 19 felony convictions for computer fraud when he was in the banking industry. So we still had questions. We had, Carolyn really honestly wanted to tell the voters that she's running an honest shop. She needed to assure herself, and she needed to, we both wanted to assure ourselves and the voters. So that began a process of discussions that went on for a long time, some brainstorming. And an idea took shape and was substantial enough by 2005 that Carolyn, in front of an audience of over 100 civil libertarians in Southern Humboldt, announced the essence of what we now call the Election Transparency Project. What she proposed is we take the ballots, hand-marked ballots, that had been run through the GEM software, after they'd been run through the GEM software, and run them through an off-the-shelf office scanner, basically something that snapped pictures of every ballot as it went through. And at the end of the election, we'd compile them, put them on DVDs, CDs, and even possibly put them on the internet, and make them available to the public. To quote her at that event, she said, "And then any citizen can count the ballots any way they want, and they could hand click on their home computer, click through the images, and tally just as if they were in the elections office. Or if they had the skill, they could write the software or have somebody else write the software to count the ballots." Well, that was warmly received, big applause, and it was 2.5 years later before we actually did it. During that period of time, there was a lot of bumps, twists and turns in the road. Financial, we spent a lot of time trying to get grants to buy that sort of scanner we needed. Well, we found out logistically that we tried one of her scanners in the clerk's office and it wasn't up to the task. It was legal and there were political questions, which potentially could have stopped us, but we kept going. And in the period between then and when we